work was completed early.
As with all special
orbiter stay in High Bay 2 was only 77
Here at
days.
Space Center, work on Columbia
During
began.
This time, technicians installed the International Microgravity Laboratory 2 and accomplished several additional achievements as well. These achievements included change-out of a hydrogen tank on the vehicle's cryogenic pallet. Installed on the Columbia in mid-1992, the cryogenic pallet supplies extra propellants to the space shuttle, allowing the vehicle to stay in space much longer. For example, the average flight time for shuttles without a cryogenic pallet is 9 days. With this type of pallet, an orbiter's average flight time is extended to 16 days. Other Columbia processing achievements for this flow include torque box modification of the payload bay doors, which adds stiffness to the bay doors to improve the vehicle's tolerance to wind shears. Because wind is always a factor in launch decisions, it is hoped that this modification will extend the vehicle's shear wind launch capability. During its stay, the Columbia also received 163 new tile bonds. Rollover of the Space Shuttle Columbia from the orbiter processing facility to the vehicle assembly building occurred at 6:07 p.m. last Wednesday, June 8th. Originally scheduled for 9 a.m., the event was delayed for several hours by one of our traditional Florida thunderstorms. When the sky finally cleared late in the afternoon, managers took quick advantage of the sunshine and blue skies to begin a flawless move to the vehicle assembly building's High Bay 1. Rollover operations are performed using the orbiter transporter, which is really a one-of-a-kind transportation system. In fact, it's the only one we have. The vehicle was originally designed to move space shuttle orbiters across the mountainous terrain at Vandenberg Air Force Base in California. Of course, the roads at Kennedy Space Center are not nearly as challenging, but the vehicle has still proven to be quite beneficial. For example, before the orbiter transporter arrived at Kennedy Space Center, rollover operations were performed by towing the shuttle with its landing gear down to the vehicle assembly building. This often resulted in minor tire damage, which required tire changeouts in the vehicle assembly building. Now that we use the orbiter transporter, the tires put on the orbiter in the processing facility are the same tires that will stay on the shuttle until it lands back on Earth at the conclusion of its mission. While the Space Shuttle Columbia was making its move to the Vehicle Assembly Building, the Space Shuttle Discovery was making the same journey in reverse. While Columbia was in High Bay 2, Discovery was in the Vehicle Assembly Building with its purge air on, awaiting its opportunity to take Columbia's place in the processing facility. Now that Columbia has moved, work has begun in the processing bay to prepare the Space Shuttle Discovery for mission STS-64, which is scheduled for launch this fall. Once inside the vehicle assembly building, preparations begin to mate the orbiter Columbia to the external tank and solid rocket booster stack. Lifting operations began the evening that the vehicle rolled in. Early lifting is performed by 250-ton cranes, which raise the orbiter using slings mounted on the orbiter's forward and aft sections. Once raised, the aft beam and sling were removed, and the orbiter was rotated to a vertical position. The orbiter was then lifted over the building's 16th floor crossover beam. Once in position, the vehicle was soft mated to the external tank and solid rocket booster stack. During soft mate, the vehicle was lined up to the proper connection points and configured for final mate. After numerous systems verifications and closeouts, the Space Shuttle Columbia was prepared for rollout, the 3.4-mile trip to the launch pad. All essential personnel were on station at 8 p.m. Tuesday evening. Engineers and technicians configured the smoke detectors on the mobile launcher platform and opened the vehicle assembly building's high bay doors. The crawler transporter, which carries the Space Shuttle stack to the launch pad, arrives at the vehicle assembly building many hours in advance. Approximately 2 to 3 hours before rollout, operators start and stabilize the crawler transporter vehicle. It takes about 45 minutes to get the crawler stabilized underneath the shuttle's mobile launcher platform. At this point, personnel disconnect ground power and use crawler transporter power.
The last of the final hour of rollout preparations is retraction of the work platforms that surround the space shuttle while it is in the building. These platforms provide close-up access to all parts of the space shuttle to enable workers to perform their tasks on the vehicle. Most of these platforms are mechanical and are actually part of the vehicle assembly building's structure. First movement of the space shuttle rollout occurred at approximately 11:26 p.m. Tuesday evening. During the six-hour trip to the launch pad, the space shuttle is mounted on the mobile launcher platform and is carried to the pad atop the crawler transporter. The mobile launcher platform is a two-story steel structure that was first used in the Apollo-Saturn program and then modified for the space shuttle program. Because the launch platform is actually what the space shuttle is launched from at the pad, it has three openings, one for the main engine's exhaust and two for the solid rocket booster's exhaust. Surviving the extreme conditions of a launch is no easy feat for the mobile platform. To keep up with burn damage, technicians must sand and paint the platforms after every launch. Like the mobile launcher platforms, the crawler transporters were originally used during the Apollo era and then modified for shuttle use. The surface area of the crawler is roughly about the size of a baseball diamond. Each crawler weighs about 6 million pounds unloaded. The crawler has 8 tracks, each of which has 57 shoes or cleats. These shoes weigh about 1 ton each. With the space shuttle aboard, the crawler can creep at a maximum speed of about 1 mile per hour, only half of its unloaded speed. With the rollout successfully completed, the space shuttle Columbia will now undergo final preparations at the pad. Within the next few hours, the rotating service structure will be moved to enclose the vehicle, which allows workers access to perform their work. The first major order of business will be launch pad validation, which involves connecting and checking interfaces between the space shuttle and the launch pad. Next week, workers will load the hypergolic fuels into the orbital maneuvering system pods and the forward reaction control system. The terminal countdown demonstration test, which is basically a full-run practice countdown involving all essential personnel, including the astronauts, is slated for June 22nd, and the astronaut crew is scheduled to arrive in Florida on June 19th for that test. The flight readiness review is slated for June 23rd, after which shuttle managers will select the official launch date. Technicians at the pad are scheduled to perform ordnance installations on June 29th. Remaining work after that is to close out the aft engine compartment. This involves final vehicle inspections and platform removals. Launch of Columbia is currently targeted for July 8th. The upcoming STS-65 mission promises to be an exciting one. 7 space agencies worldwide involving 13 countries will conduct some 80 experiments during the planned 2-week mission. Projects planned include several life sciences experiments, such as the Aquatic Animal Experiment Unit, in which scientists will study the spawning, embryology, and behavior of various newts and fish. There are also over 10 microgravity experiments planned, as well as 4 major science experiment payloads. In the Air Force Maui Optical Site, or AMIS, calibration test, researchers will test ground-based optical sensors to examine contamination and exhaust plume phenomena. The Orbital Acceleration Research Experiment will increase our knowledge of orbital drag technology by shedding some light on the fundamental airflow phenomena in the Earth's upper atmosphere. In the MAST experiment, or military application of ship trails, the flight crew will take high-resolution photographs of ship tracks by aiming their cameras out the aft flight deck windows. From these photographs, researchers will analyze wake formation and dissipation. Mission STS-65 is of special interest to amateur radio operators because on this mission, Columbia will be carrying the Shuttle Amateur Radio Experiment 2. This involves the operation of an amateur radio by licensed astronauts during the off-duty hours of the mission. On this mission, Columbia will carry a 7-member crew, Commander Robert Cabana, Pilot James Halsell, and the 5 mission specialists Carl Waltz, Rick Hebe, Leroy Chow, Donald Thomas, and Chiaki Mukai. This concludes our coverage of Columbia's rollout to Launch Pad 39A. On behalf of NASA Select here at the Kennedy Space Center, we thank you for joining us.
2, 1, 0, +1, +2. Die US Air Force hat vom Cape Canaveral eine Titan IV gestartet. Hinter der Nutzlastverkleidung verbirgt sich der Spionagesatellit Aquacade. Der 1 Milliarde teure Weltraumspion wird mit einer 90 Meter langen Antenne weltweit Funk- und Telefongespräche belauschen. Es fragt sich nur, von wem. Dieser neue Satellit wurde entwickelt, um den Funkverkehr der Sowjetunion abzuhören. Unglücklicherweise existiert die Sowjetunion nicht mehr, also ein Satellit ohne Aufgabe. Diese Meinung wird das amerikanische Verteidigungsministerium sicherlich nicht vertreten.
On July 7, 1992, the comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 passed about 16,000 miles from Jupiter's cloud cover and started to break into pieces. The Hubble Space Telescope was able to count 21 separate sections, and NASA provided these pictures of what they call a string of pearls. But the new photographs NASA is releasing today show that some of the 21 pieces seem to have disappeared, and nobody knows for sure where the missing pieces went. Nothing like a collision between a comet this large and a planet has ever been seen by scientists, so there's a lot of speculation about what may happen after the comet hits Jupiter's atmosphere and begins to travel through it. One theory is the fragments could travel more than 200 miles into Jupiter's atmosphere. At a speed of 37 miles a second, they'd explode something like a nuclear bomb. The explosion could equal 20 million megatons, nearly 500,000 times larger than the largest nuclear detonation ever seen on Earth. It could send a mushroom cloud 1,500 miles into Jupiter's atmosphere. Another possibility is that the fragments could disintegrate as soon as they hit the outer edges of Jupiter's atmosphere. If that happened, there would be the most spectacular meteor shower ever seen. Whatever happens, virtually every big telescope on Earth will be watching, and the Galileo Space Probe and the Hubble Space Telescope will be taking pictures from space. Reed, some scientific speculators say it might have been something like this, a huge comet impact which killed the dinosaurs that roamed the Earth 65 million years ago.
I guess the question is, will any of this be visible to the naked eye here on Earth?
Absolutely. Even though Jupiter is 400 million miles away and we won't be in any danger from this, we'll be able to see it, perhaps with the naked eye. They say Jupiter may vibrate like a bell after you ring it after this happens, and it'll be about twice as bright in the sky as it is tonight. And this happens on July 16th, and we will provide coverage from as many different places as we can find our own telescopes.
All right, where it isn't cloudy anyway. Thank you, John Holloman.
As our faithful viewers know, Jupiter is going to have a blast this summer, compliments of a comet that will crash into the giant planet mid-July. This past week, astronomers released some new pictures and computer animation of the comet called Shoemaker-Levy 9. As CNN's John Holloman reports, astronomers are gearing up to catch a glimpse of what will happen when the comet hits Jupiter. Will it be the celestial show of the century or a cosmic dud?
In 2 months, pieces of this comet will begin to pound the surface of Jupiter. They could bash the largest planet in the solar system with more energy than all the atomic bombs in the world. For some astronomers, it's the event of a lifetime.
Every telescope available will be pointed toward Jupiter, not only looking for evidence of the collisions themselves, but also monitoring any changes in Jupiter or the environment of Jupiter.
This is the largest of the string of pearl comets. It's expected to hit Jupiter on the 18th of July, and it could be the biggest explosion ever witnessed by human beings.
Here's an artist's conception of what could happen. The comet fragments plummet through Jupiter's atmosphere at a speed of 37 miles a second.
The explosion starts at the bottom of the atmosphere, propagates up that tube left by the comet's entry,
and basically explodes out the top of the atmosphere.
Jupiter is so large, there probably won't be permanent damage. But the astronomer who discovered the comet says if it crashed on Earth, it would be catastrophic.
We're talking about 100 million megatons of kinetic energy. I think we're talking about the kind of event that's associated with mass extinctions of species on Earth. That is really and truly a global catastrophe. It might not take out the human race, but it would certainly be very bad times.
Jupiter is 400 million miles away, so there's no threat to Earth. Astronomers are not even sure how impressive the pictures will be. You'll probably need a telescope to see what happens. They've created computer animations to show what they hope will happen the week of July 16th, but they readily admit the collision between Comet Shoemaker-Levy and Jupiter could turn out to be a bust. John Holloman, CNN Washington.
Astronomers are hopeful they might get a good look at the Shoemaker-Levy impacts through the Hubble Space Telescope. This week, the now 2020 Hubble offered up the best images yet of an exploding star or supernova. The picture shows supernova 1987A encircled by three rings. What are they, you ask? Well, astronomers aren't sure, but their best guess is they are projected by a high-energy beam of radiation, sort of a cosmic laser light show. One of the great mysteries of the universe has been solved, and while astronomers are jumping for joy, it might seem like an anticlimax to you. Pictures taken by the Hubble Space Telescope confirm beyond a shadow of a doubt the existence of black holes in space. CNN's John Holloman has details.
This picture is evidence that there's a huge black hole in space. It's spinning at a million miles an hour and swallowing everything around it.
It's at least 2 billion times the mass of the sun, and maybe even as much as 3 billion. So there truly are billions and billions of stars that have collapsed inside and been eaten by this black hole.
The Hubble Space Telescope took the picture in February, and measurements made by other instruments prove the black hole exists.
This is the mother of all black holes that we've found so far.
Astronomers say the discovery is important because it confirms Einstein's theory of relativity and it helps explain the origin of the universe. Astronomers compare it to a ravenous beast in space, swallowing planets and spewing a jet of gas from its center.
It's growing as it eats, and so it's probably been growing over the whole history of the universe. This thing will keep eating as long as a meal is around.
But astronomers agree the black hole is so far from the Earth, it won't affect this planet. They believe they've found other black holes in distant galaxies. Scientists admit they don't know if there's one in our own Milky Way galaxy. If there is one that could someday threaten the Earth, it's fasting right now.
Scientists say this picture is certainly the greatest discovery to date made by the Hubble Space Telescope. But they point out that now that the telescope has been repaired, the best could be yet to come. John Holloman, CNN, NASA headquarters in Washington.
Of course, NASA astronomers aren't the only people who study outer space. For some high school students, the stars are just a few keystrokes away. CNN's Don Knapp tells us about a new astronomy program that lets kids get their hands on the universe with personal computers.
When UC Berkeley's Leuschner Observatory opens the night skies, classroom computers open the observatory to high schoolers across the country in a national educational project called Hands on Universe.
As it gets closer to Jupiter, the spacing will get larger.
These Albany, California high schoolers use fresh images of Jupiter and its moons to calculate the planet's mass.
And it's just not like textbook where you just read the book and then, you know, try to understand the concept and apply formulas. It's more than that. It's so real, you know.
Students at Oil City High School in Pennsylvania ordered the observatory to take a picture of a well-known whirlpool galaxy 13 million light years away. By chance, they captured a rare event, pictures of a supernova in its earliest stages.
I mean, it's really nice that you found something and you gave something to science.
Such supernovas occur in a galaxy perhaps once in 50 or 100 years. Scientists programmed their Leuschner telescope to look for the exploding stars by making as many as 500 images a night.
You know, we put our heads together and we said, why can't we have the high school classroom request these images, bring them into our classrooms over phone lines, and have the students do work?
Classroom computers in 30 high schools from coast to coast use phone lines to retrieve the telescope's pictures.
They're not learning a lot of detailed astronomy. They're learning what a real astronomer does,
such as using math and geometry and physics to explain what they see.
It's interesting to see how math fits into stuff, because I like math.
2 months ago, Heather Tartera didn't know what a supernova was.
And then you just like look up and go, well, what am I going to find tonight? What's different? Like,
now she's an astronomer with a resume. Don Knapp, CNN, reporting.
Der Rahmen der internationalen Luft- und Raumfahrtausstellung ist etwas kleiner geworden. Weit weniger Hersteller als bei der letzten Messe präsentierten sich in Schönefeld. Es herrscht Flaute im Flugzeuggeschäft. Die Deutsche Aerospace, bisher größter Aussteller, hat wegen finanzieller Schwierigkeiten die Teilnahme gänzlich abgesagt. Doch nichtsdestotrotz, es waren vor allem die Vorführungen am Himmel, die Tausende von Besuchern zur ILA lockten. Tiefflüge der Militärmaschinen, sie faszinierten jedoch nicht alle. Bürgerinitiativen und Umweltgruppen protestierten am Rande. Schaufliegen eines Phantomflugzeuges. In knapp 150 Metern donnerte es über die Köpfe der Besucher hinweg. Im gemächlichen Formationszug dagegen die Oldtimer der Flugschau, Doppeldecker. Und immer wieder faszinierte Kunststücke von Hubschrauberpiloten. Eine Woche lang wird am Rande des Flughafens Schönefeld bei laufendem Betrieb die ILA geöffnet sein. Bis dahin werden es wohl mehrere Hunderttausende sein, die sich von der Faszination der Flugtechnik in den Bann ziehen lassen.
Die ILA ist aber auch Messe für den militärischen Bereich, Ost und West. Was vor Jahren noch undenkbar schien, heute sind sie zum Fassen nah. Die Sukhoi 27, hier neben einer F-16. Entschärfend wirkt da auf dem Gelände der Themenschwerpunkt humanitäre Luftfahrt. Neu erfunden wurde die ILA in der ILA. Drei Hallen sind vor allem dem fachlich orientierten Publikum gewidmet. Neben Triebwerken und Raumfahrtaccessoires auch ein Stand mit Leihgaben des Museums des Gagarin-Kosmonauten-Vorbereitungszentrums des Sternstädtchens in Moskau.
Mr. Leonov,
Alexei Leonov, Sie sind ein berühmter Kosmonaut. Vor allem in Ostdeutschland sind Sie bekannt. Was haben Sie denn so alles gemacht? Ja, vielen Dank erst einmal für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit. Ich kann mich noch ganz gut an den ersten Kosmonauten Gagarin erinnern. Ich selbst war zweimal im Weltraum. Das erste Mal, das war 1965. Während meines Fluges führte ich auch Experimente außerhalb der Kapsel durch. Und das waren im Grunde genommen die ersten Schritte im All überhaupt. Mein zweiter Flug war dann 10 Jahre später, 1975. Ich war der Kosmonaut unseres gemeinsamen Programms Soyuz Apollo. Wir übten damals verschiedene Manöver, andocken oder auch den gemeinsamen Flug. Die ILA ist die westlichste Messe des Ostens und auch die östlichste Messe des Westens. Ein Ost-West-Handelszentrum vermittelt Geschäftskontakte. Geschäfte machen aber auch die Restaurationsbetriebe auf der ILA.
Hunger und Durst, liebe Zuschauer, sollten Sie zu Hause lassen. Ein Auszug aus der Preisliste, 2 Kaffee, eine Bockwurst und eine Bulette, 16,60 Mark. In Anbetracht der vielen ausländischen Gäste und Zuschauer, unverständlich.
Hat die internationale Raumfahrt eine Krise. Man beflügelt sich nicht mehr gegenseitig. Man kooperiert auch nicht, man wirft die Ressourcen auch nicht zusammen, sondern man stagniert schlicht. Ist das eine korrekte Analyse, Herr Fuhrer?
Ich bin mir nicht so ganz sicher. Sicherlich ist es wahr, dass es den Antrieb, den man immer meint, gesehen zu haben, dass der eine besser sein will als der andere, dass der Antrieb nicht mehr da ist. Aber wenn ich mir angucke, was in der Raumfahrt passiert, so ist es nicht so, dass erheblich weniger passiert ist. Es passiert weniger spektakulär, was man in der Raumfahrt macht. Und was wir heute ja, so etwas im Hintergrund eigentlich jeden Tag tun, das ist, wir starten Satelliten, mit denen wir reden können. Wir starten Satelliten, mit denen wir unsere Erde angucken können. Und natürlich auch, wir bauen Raumstationen. Allerdings gebe ich zu, natürlich mit einer etwas Verzögerung gegenüber den Plänen, die wir früher hatten. Aber auch die Tatsache, dass man nicht miteinander zusammen etwas auf die Beine stellt, hat ja noch was anderes zu tun. Das ist ja nicht notwendigerweise die Tatsache, wenn ich mit Ihnen nicht mehr Feind bin, können wir zusammenarbeiten. Ich finde das schändlich. Es gibt keine einzige Universität, die sagt, ich mache meine Tore nicht auf, weil es da drüben auch eine keine Universität gibt. Es ist auch ein normaler, gesunder Wettbewerb notwendig, damit sie überhaupt Leistung erbringen können. Also man darf nicht immer sagen, wenn wir uns nicht bekriegen, sollten wir alle nur noch eine einzige Organisation haben, mit der wir gemeinsam sowas tun.
Nicht eine einzige, aber bestimmten Austausch, bestimmte Ressourcen zusammenlegen. Herr Feustel-Büchel, ESA, Sie sind da verantwortlich, gerade auch für die bemannte Raumfahrt. Sie hatten das ehrgeizige Projekt Ariane 5 mit dem Beiprojekt Hermes, das so etwas Ähnliches sein sollte wie ein Konkurrenzunternehmen zum Shuttle der Amerikaner. Sie haben sich davon verabschiedet, nicht aus philosophischen Gründen, sondern eigentlich aus Kostengründen.
Das ist richtig. Wir hatten in der Konferenz in Den Haag 1987 sehr ehrgeizige Pläne. Zu diesem Zeitpunkt wollten wir in Zusammenarbeit mit den Amerikanern eine große Raumstation errichten und gleichzeitig die entsprechenden Transportmittel schaffen. Die Mittelsituation nach dieser Ministerkonferenz in Den Haag hat sich so entwickelt, wie Sie vorher sagten. Die Mittel haben insgesamt stagniert, sodass eine solche Möglichkeit nicht mehr gegeben war. Wir haben aber dennoch auf dem Gebiet der bemannten Raumfahrt heute sowohl mit Orbitalstationen wie auch mit Transportsystemen noch sehr ehrgeizige Pläne. Die sind zwar ein wenig reduziert gegenüber den Originalplänen, aber dennoch sind wir voll überzeugt in der ESA, dass die bemannte Raumfahrt ihre Berechtigung hat, und wir sind auch nach wie vor dabei, solche Programme vorzubereiten.
Wo ist sie eigentlich, die Berechtigung der bemannten Raumfahrt? Ich meine, wir haben während der ganzen Monddebatte unheimlich viel über Spill- und Teflonpfannen geredet. Gilt das heute auch noch so?
Die Berechtigung der bemannten Raumfahrt ist heute ein bisschen schwer abzusehen. Aber man muss in der Raumfahrt immer ein vernünftiges Mix aus verschiedenen Programmen sehen. Es gibt Programme bei uns in der ESA, wie zum Beispiel die Ariane, die Sie erwähnt haben, die sehr kommerziell orientiert sind. Wir haben zwei Drittel über die Firma Arianespace, zwei Drittel des Weltmarktes auf dem Telekommunikationssatellitensektor erobert, die wir starten mit der Ariane. Wir haben eine wirklich konsolidierte Position. Ich selbst war 1973, als die Entscheidung für die Ariane getroffen wurde, bei der Raumfahrt. Wenn Sie damals jemand gesagt hätten, dass die Europäer pro Monat eine Ariane starten und dies für die Amerikaner tun und für Südamerika und Japan tun, dann hätte man gesagt, dieser Mann hat keine vernünftige Überlegung. Dennoch ist es mit Ehrgeiz und mit Entschlossenheit dazu gekommen. Ich glaube, dass wir bei der bemannten Raumfahrt heute an einem ähnlichen Punkt stehen. Es ist schwer zu sagen, das wird ein Erfolg sein, das wird kein Erfolg sein. Aber was man sicher sagen kann, ist, wenn Europa auf dem Gebiet der Raumfahrt insgesamt dabei sein will, muss es auch auf dem Gebiet der bemannten Raumfahrt dabei sein. Viele Dinge werden sich erst in der Zukunft ergeben. Herr Forer hat Ihnen erzählt über die Raumfahrtmöglichkeiten. Als er geflogen ist, da ist man eine Woche geflogen für eine Mission. Was wir schaffen wollen in Europa und weltweit, ist geordnete Laborbedingungen, wo 24 Stunden rund um die Uhr Wissenschaftler und Forscher und später vielleicht auch Leute, die Anwendungstechnik betreiben, solche Labors benutzen können. All dieses ist noch vor uns, all dieses müssen wir schaffen, und wir müssen einen gewissen Teil unserer Einsätze, unserer Mittel dafür aufwenden, um diese Voraussetzungen zu schaffen. In 10, 20 Jahren, wenn wir den Willen haben, wird sich dann erweisen, ob diese Dinge Sinn machen. Ich bin überzeugt davon, dass diese Dinge in vielen Bereichen sehr viel mehr Sinn machen werden, als wir uns heute vorstellen können.
Herr Vollvogt, Sie stellen sozusagen der ESA die Success Story, die Ariane 4, zur Verfügung. Die zweite Stufe wird bei Ihnen gebaut. Die Ariane, die besonders durch die Telekommunikation, durch die Satelliten, die Sie hochschießen, ja, die praktisch alle 8 Tage starten könnte, die Aufträge haben, im Stau hat, auch durch den Unfall mit der Stufe 3 unlängst in Kourou. Der ökonomische Teil in Europa, der ist anscheinend ganz okay. Ist der wissenschaftlich-philosophische Teil, die Unterstützung von Regierungen, von politischen Gruppierungen, ist der auch okay?
Wir haben auf diesem Gebiet in letzter Zeit, ich würde sagen in den letzten ein, zwei Jahren, natürlich gewisse Probleme gehabt, die sich ergeben haben aus den grundsätzlichen Veränderungen, die wir hier in der Welt gehabt haben, in der Politik, die zu Konsequenzen geführt haben auf dem Budgetgebiet. Und was wir im Moment natürlich nicht haben in Europa, ist ein klar definiertes Ziel von politischer Seite. Raumfahrt wird ja von der Politik unterstützt und von den Regierungen und Steuerzahlern und Parlamenten bezahlt. Und wir brauchen natürlich, insbesondere in den Agenturen wie der ESA, aber auch den nationalen Agenturen und der Industrie, eine gewisse Verlässlichkeit der Planung. Wir gehen im Moment durch einen sehr schwierigen Prozess des Personalabbaus in unserer Industrie, Anpassung an niedrigere Budgets. Und wir sind überzeugt davon und haben Vorstellungen, wie das insgesamt mit der Raumfahrt weitergehen muss. Was wichtig ist, ist natürlich, dass auch auf politischem Level, auf dem Level der Regierung und der Parlamente, jetzt in Zukunft einmal wieder gesagt wird, wo wollen wir eigentlich hin mit der Raumfahrt, wie soll es weitergehen und welche Budgetmittel aus unseren Haushalten wollen wir dafür ausgeben.
Was sind denn Ihre Prioritäten, wenn Sie sagen, Sie haben Vorstellungen, Sie persönlich haben Vorstellungen, wie es weitergehen sollte, könnte, müsste?
Wir haben ganz dezidierte Vorstellungen auf dem Gebiet der Satelliten. Wir wissen, dass wir hier in Europa, insbesondere in den Industriestrukturen, große Anstrengungen unternehmen müssen, um auf diesem Gebiet auch in Zukunft wettbewerbsfähig zu bleiben, beziehungsweise erst zu werden, insbesondere gegenüber den amerikanischen Konkurrenten. Wir wissen, dass wir die Möglichkeiten der Raumfahrt ganz intensiv einsetzen müssen für Nutzer auf der Erde, sei es die Telekommunikation, sei es die Erdbeobachtung, sei es militärische Erdbeobachtung für Friedenssicherung. Und wir wissen natürlich auch, dass wir langfristig weiterhin an der bemannten Raumfahrt teilnehmen müssen. Es ist vollkommen klar in unseren Augen, dass Raumfahrt auch in Zukunft ganz erhebliche Beiträge leisten wird zur Lösung großer globaler Probleme auf vielen verschiedenen Gebieten. Und wir müssen die industriellen Fähigkeiten, die wir in der Vergangenheit mit vielen Milliarden von Steuergeldern aufgebaut haben, erhalten. Die können Sie nicht einfach heute abschalten und morgen wieder anschalten. Das ist ein langfristiges Geschäft, in dem wir hier drin sind. Und eine Industrie- und Kulturnation wie die Deutschen, meinen wir und meine ich, kann es sich nicht leisten, aufgrund kurzfristiger Probleme aus wichtigen Hochtechnologiegebieten auszusteigen. Wir müssen hier langfristig drin bleiben. Dass das Geld knapper geworden ist, ist etwas, was wir natürlich wissen. Und wir haben uns darauf eingestellt, beziehungsweise sind im Prozess, uns darauf einzustellen.
Bevor ich Reinhard Vohr die Vorlage zuspiele, ein kurzer Thesenfilmregie, bitte Achtung, von meinem Kollegen und Experten NTV, Raumfahrtexperten Volker Kado.
Um sich Zugang zum Weltraum zu verschaffen, vertrauen weltweit bereits mehr als 90% aller Firmen, die kommerzielle Satelliten betreiben, auf Arianespace. Fernsprechverkehr, Fernsehen, Datenübertragung, Erdbeobachtung, Meteorologie, wissenschaftliche Missionen. Dies sind die Früchte einer Zusammenarbeit, die ständig umfangreicher wird. Arianespace bringt jährlich etwa 10 Satelliten in die Umlaufbahn der Erde, um der Nachfrage seiner Kunden nachzukommen.
Das ist ja alles sehr schön und gut. Reicht Ihnen das? Da ist zum Beispiel immer wieder die Kritik, dass die NASA ein viel effizienterer Verein ist, mit besseren Querverbindungen zu Industrie und Politik, und dass die ESA das etwas schlafmütziger angeht?
Ja, erstmal muss man ganz simpel mal nachgucken, was ist der Unterschied zwischen ESA und NASA. Der Unterschied ist der, dass wir in Europa ein Haufen von verschiedenen Nationen sind, ein buntes Volk, das, wie ich meine, sehr schön ist, dass wir das sind. Ich liebe die Sprache des anderen, seine andere Kultur.
Aber wenn Sie gemeinsam sich zusammensetzen und was tun wollen, das sehen wir in anderen Bereichen ebenfalls und nicht nur in der Raumfahrt, dann haben Sie eben auch Reibungsverluste zu überwinden. Deswegen ist erstmal von primär ein europäisches Konsortium aus verschiedenen Nationen mit verschiedenen Interessen und verschiedenen Lokalitäten und verschiedenen persönlichen Eigenheiten hat es natürlich schwieriger. Aber das ist nun das Schicksal Europas. Von vornherein müssen wir diese Reibungsverluste überwinden. Wenn Sie jetzt nachgucken, was wir auf die Beine gestellt haben, natürlich ist es grauenvoll, wenn Sie ein Kampfflugzeug bauen und an jeder Stelle ist eine andere Farbe und eine andere Nationalflagge dran. Dann sagen Sie, kann ich es nicht irgendwo anders bauen. Es geht nicht, wir wollen es nicht. Wir wollen auch durch so eine Kooperation in Europa politisch verzahnt werden. Und das ist unser Preis. Deswegen zurück zur NASA. Jeder, der mit der NASA zusammengearbeitet hat, weiß, die hat auch ganz nette administrative Probleme, die einfach was damit zu tun haben. Wenn Sie die Anzahl von Menschen über 3 erhöhen, kriegen Sie administrative Probleme. Das ist der Grund, warum Sie als Fernsehsender vielleicht billiger arbeiten können, weil Sie weniger sind.
Wir sind auch schon 4 hier.
Ja, immerhin. Gut, aber wir sind 4 von den 4, reden 3 und einer bedient die Kamera. Im öffentlichen, rechtlichen ist es anders. Aus diesem Grunde ist es sicherlich in Europa ein bisschen schwieriger. Nur, wir haben eine ganze Reihe von Dingen geschafft und wir müssen sie weitermachen. Wir haben keine Alternative.
Ich spiele den Ball mal an den ESA-Verantwortlichen zurück. Sie haben diese Panne, dieses Pech gehabt mit der Treibstoffpumpe in der Stufe 3 der Ariane vor ein paar Wochen. Man hat lange Zeit auf diesen Fehler, auf dieses Risiko oder auf diese Lücke, auf diesen Mangel aufmerksam gemacht. Und wenn meine Informationen stimmen, dann ist der bürokratische Weg so gewesen, dass man gesagt hat, naja, bei Flug 67 werden wir uns dem Problem annehmen. Flug 63 ist explodiert. Liegt da nicht Selbstverschulden, bürokratisches Sand im Getriebe, selbst auch bei Ihnen, dass Sie erkennen könnten und effizienter werden könnten?
Also jeder kann immer wieder effizienter werden. Das trifft für uns alle zu, das können wir sicherlich auch. Aber erstens mal muss ich noch zu dem vorherigen ein bisschen was sagen. Sie sprachen von Schlafmützigkeit. Wenn Sie sich einmal die Budgets angucken, die wir in Europa haben, und wenn Sie sich mal das NASA-Budget angucken oder auch das russische Budget, dann stellen Sie fest, dass dort ein Unterschied in einem Faktor 10 ist. Wir haben bei der ESA ein Budget von 2,5 Milliarden EQ. Die US-amerikanische Raumfahrt hat etwa 30 Milliarden Dollar. Die Russen kann man schwerer bewerten, aber das war zumindest bis vor kurzem so. Und wenn Sie sich mal anschauen, was die europäische Seite leistet, Sie haben gerade vorher die Ariane angesprochen, wir haben 2/3 des Weltmarktes auf dem Transportsektor, wir sind im wissenschaftlichen Bereich akzeptiert, und zwar weltweit akzeptiert sind die wissenschaftlichen Leistungen unseres Programms. Wir haben auf dem Gebiet der Erdbeobachtung hervorragende Ergebnisse, Meteorologie, Sie sehen jeden Tag Ihren Wetterdienst über unsere Wettersatelliten. Ich glaube, Europa braucht sich in keinem Bereich zu verstecken. Europa gilt sogar als besonders effizient und besonders
erfolgreich.
Der Unfall in Kourou hätte immer vermieden werden können, wenn Sie vorher gewusst hätten, warum der Unfall passiert ist. Aber das weiß kein Mensch. Der Unfall in Kourou ist eine Geschichte, die bedauerlich ist, aber das ist keine Katastrophe. Der Unfall in Kourou ist derzeit unter Behebung. Wir werden wahrscheinlich am Samstag eine neue Ariane starten. Die Zuverlässigkeit der Ariane ist unbestritten in der Welt und man kann also mit absoluter Sicherheit sagen, dass solche Unterstellungen, dass das vorher bekannt wäre, völlig aus der Luft gegriffen sind. Sonst würde mit Sicherheit keine Versicherung bezahlen, sonst würde mit Sicherheit hier eine doch größere Investigation vorgenommen werden, was nicht der Fall ist.
Also ich würde gerne noch mal einen Satz dazu sagen, weil hier ist es mit einer unbemannten Rakete passiert. Die bemannte Raumfahrt hat ja nun leider Gottes auch, zumindest im westlichen Bereich, einen tragischen Unfall, der im Übrigen gleich nach meinem Flug passiert ist, zu beklagen gehabt. Ich möchte hier mal ganz klar sagen, dass diejenigen Leute, die in die Raketen einsteigen, also auch wir, erheblich weniger kritisch mit den Raketenbauern umgehen als alle anderen, die allenfalls mit ihrem Auto über die Straße fahren. Ich will damit nur noch mal sagen, ich halte es für unfair. Ein so komplexes System, versuchen wir alle das Beste. Natürlich gibt es Fehler. Hinterher ist jeder schlauer. Nur wenn Sie umgekehrt sagen würden, ich gehe dann und nur dann, wenn mit 99,999%iger Wahrscheinlichkeit überall ausgeschlossen werden kann, das, was passiert, würden Sie nie gehen. Also müssen wir immer abschätzen, welches Restrisiko tragen wir. Und wenn Sie in Ihrer Abschätzung richtig waren, sind Sie der Gute. Dann haben Sie einen Raumflug gemacht, der billig ist, effizient und schnell geht. Wenn Sie einmal auf die Nase fallen, steht die ganze Nation auf und jeder, der Schwierigkeiten hat, seinen Tauchsieder zu Hause anzuschalten, beschuldigt diejenigen, dass sie falsch eine Rakete gebaut hätten. Das finde ich unfair und wir müssen uns irgendwann mal dagegen wehren, dass wir eigentlich immer nur diejenigen sind, die zu Kasse gebeten werden, die man beschuldigt. Man sollte auch mal anerkennen, dass sie mit so wenigen Unfällen solche hochkomplizierten technischen Vorhaben realisieren.
Herr Pollvogt, die Konkurrenz, Standort Deutschland, die Konkurrenz schläft auch hier nicht. Zwei Drittel sagen Sie Marktanteil bei der Ariane in der Satellitentechnologie. Die Japaner kommen mit H2, die Chinesen kommen im langen Marsch, die Russen sind auch wieder da. Wie ist das von der industriellen Seite, von Ihrer Standortdiskussionsseite her zu bewerten?
Wir haben, wie gesagt, große
Erfolge. Herr Fuhrer, wenn Sie dringend in Zeitnot sind, wir entlassen Sie gerne. Also wenn wir Ihnen da helfen, dass Sie schneller bei Ihrem nächsten Termin machen, Sie gehen Sie durchs Bild. Ich bedanke mich sehr.
Wir haben ja, wie gesagt, bei der Ariane große Erfolge gehabt, auch weil wir konkurrenzfähig waren mit unseren Preisen. Das Problem, das in Zukunft auf uns zukommen wird, ist, dass durch die veränderte Weltlage sowohl die Russen mit ihren Raketen, insbesondere der Proton-Rakete, als vielleicht auch die Chinesen mit ihren Long-March-Raketen in Zukunft auf den Markt kommen können. Und hier gibt es kein, wie man so schön sagt, Level Playing Field, also keine gleichartigen Randbedingungen für die Industrie. Es gibt hier keinen fairen Wettbewerb in dem Sinne. Und da werden wir natürlich unter Umständen Probleme haben. Was wir machen in der Industrie, ist natürlich, dass wir versuchen, so effizient und kostengünstig wie möglich zu produzieren, damit unsere Preise konkurrenzfähig bleiben. Was wir weiterhin brauchen, ist natürlich in der Weiterentwicklung solcher Systeme, und das gilt nicht nur für die Raumfahrt, das gilt ja auch für die Luftfahrt, das ist auch ein großes Thema, ist auch auf dieser Luftfahrtausstellung. Was wir weiterhin brauchen, ist natürlich auch hier staatliche Unterstützung für die Weiterentwicklung von Technologien und neuen Systemen, weil diese staatliche Unterstützung natürlich auch bei unseren Konkurrenten da ist, insbesondere bei den Amerikanern durch militärische und zivile Programme, aber auch bei den anderen großen Nationen, den Russen, den Chinesen und den Japanern. Und ich glaube, wir haben hier ein gutes Verständnis mit unserer Regierung, unseren Parlamenten, dass hier gewisse Notwendigkeiten beherrschen. Wir tun auf industrieller Seite alles, was wir wirklich tun können, um sicherzustellen, dass wir effizient und kostengünstig sind, so gut es eben im Rahmen unseres Systems möglich ist.
30 Sekunden für Sie. Ich habe noch einen schönen Film von meinem Kollegen Edgar Burkhardt, der nochmal zusammenbindet Luft- und Raumfahrt und ILA. Ihr nächstes Projekt, Ihr dringendster Wunsch?
Wenn Sie mich fragen in meiner persönlichen Verantwortung, ja. Ich bin natürlich bei der ESA verantwortlich für die bemannte Raumfahrt, ja. Ist mein Wunsch, mein persönlicher Wunsch, dass wir nach einer entsprechenden Vorbereitung, die wir jetzt laufen haben, in 1995, wenn die 13 Vertreter der europäischen Regierung zusammensitzen werden und eine sogenannte Ministerkonferenz machen, dann eine positive Entscheidung für die bemannte Raumfahrt treffen, die uns bis ins nächste Jahrtausend führt und die uns zu zuverlässigen Partnern der Amerikaner, der Kanadier, der Japaner und der Russen machen, die aller Voraussicht nach bei der Internationalen Raumstation zusammenarbeiten werden.
Ich bedanke mich sehr bei Ihnen beiden und nachträglich nochmal bei Herrn Fuhrer, der einen Anschlusstermin hatte und sowieso, wir fanden es toll, dass er uns sozusagen noch hineingezwängt hat. Sie können sich vorstellen, dass am Rande der ILA er ein volles Programm zu absolvieren hat bei seiner Attraktion als D1-Astronaut vom Jahre 85. Edgar Burkhardt noch einmal, Luft- und Raumfahrt.
Das waren noch Zeiten, als die Technik ihre Triumphe feiern durfte. Was war denn das größte Ereignis des Jahrhunderts oder gar in der gesamten bisherigen Menschheitsgeschichte? Bei einer Umfrage heute würden die Befragten erst einmal ins Grübeln kommen. Vor 25 Jahren hätte aber jeder sofort geantwortet, die Landung auf dem Mond. Die Eroberung der Lüfte und schließlich des Weltraums vollzog sich rasend schnell innerhalb von ein bis zwei Generationen. Der unbestrittene Höhepunkt eines Wettrennens der Wissenschaftler in Ost und West war 1969, als der Amerikaner Neil Armstrong als erster Mensch seinen Fuß auf den Mond setzte. Ein Menschheitstraum hatte sich erfüllt. Über Satellit wurden diese historischen Bilder weltweit im Fernsehen gezeigt. Damit machten die Amerikaner mitten im Kalten Krieg klar, sie hatten das Rennen zum Erdtrabanten gewonnen. Eine Machtdemonstration der Technologie, und schon glaubte man, dass bald auch Menschen zum Mars und zur Venus fliegen würden. Die damalige Sowjetunion gab sich nicht geschlagen. Sie baute Raumstationen, die in erdnahe Umlaufbahn operierten. Außerdem wurden unzählige Forschungs-, Kommunikations- und Aufklärungssatelliten in den Orbit geschickt. Grund auch zur Sorge über eine militärische Bedrohung aus dem All. Die Europäer zogen nur langsam nach. Ihr gemeinsames Weltraumprogramm kam nach vielen Pannen und Rückschlägen erst Anfang der 80er Jahre so richtig in Fahrt. Einen wirklichen gemeinsamen Kurs in der Weltraumfahrt haben die Staaten Europas jedoch nicht gefahren. Mit den eigenen Raketen haben sie auch nie Astronauten ins All befördert. Dafür aber gingen sie bei den Supermächten hausieren und ließen ihre Astronauten mal bei den Amerikanern und mal bei den Russen mitfliegen. Große Pläne, wie hier im Trick der europäische Raumgleiter Hermes, wurden wieder auf Eis gelegt. Das Geld ist knapp geworden. Denn immerhin kostet es eine halbe Milliarde Mark, einen einzigen Astronauten ins All und zurück zu befördern. Dann kam auf einmal auch die große Frage auf: Welchen Nutzen hat die Raumfahrt? Sie verschlingt immense Summen Geldes, aber lässt sich nicht profitabel vermarkten. Auch bei der internationalen Luftfahrt ist die Euphorie längst verflogen. Die Flugzeughersteller liefern sich einen erbitterten Konkurrenzkampf. Der tobt vor allem zwischen den US-Firmen McDonnell Douglas und Boeing und der europäischen Airbus-Industrie. Ohne dicke staatliche Subventionen würden hüben wie drüben bald keine neuen Passagierjets mehr aus den Fertigungshallen rollen. Vielleicht ist der Markt gesättigt, denn die Luftfahrtgesellschaften bestellen nur noch zögerlich neue Maschinen. Trotz steigender Passagierzahlen stecken die Airlines nämlich ihrerseits mitten im internationalen ruinösen Konkurrenzkampf. Sie kämpfen um Strecken und um die Gunst der Fluggäste. Deshalb unterbieten sie sich immer wieder gegenseitig bei den Preisen für die Tickets. Ein Konkurrenzkampf, der fast alle Fluggesellschaften tief ins Defizit gebracht hat. Auch die deutsche Lufthansa musste federn lassen. Lufthansa-Chef Weber verordnete eine Rosskur. Kosten reduzieren, wo es nur geht. Personalabbau, Straffung der Flugpläne, stärkere Auslastung der Maschinen und auch eine gewisse Reduzierung im Service. Betriebssanierung, Sparen an allen Ecken und Enden, nur nicht, wie immer wieder versichert wird, am hohen Sicherheitsstandard. Die Lufthansa ist die Gesellschaft mit den wenigsten Pannen und den pünktlichsten Start- und Landezeiten. So soll es auch bleiben, wenngleich das Bordpersonal Zweifel anmeldet. Der Belegschaft fällt das freundliche Lächeln immer schwerer. Die Beförderungschancen sinken gegen Null. Für teures Geld fertig ausgebildete junge Piloten werden oft vor die Wahl gestellt, entweder als Steward zu arbeiten oder bei einer anderen Gesellschaft einen Job zu suchen. Doch das ist angesichts einer weltweiten Pilotenschwemme und der Krise in der gesamten Branche fast aussichtslos. Doch immerhin, das Lufthansa-Sanierungskonzept beginnt zu wirken. Die Ertragslage hat sich gebessert und ein Lichtblick ist auch das Kooperationsabkommen mit der US-Gesellschaft United Airlines. Trotzdem, die Lufthansa ist auf einem turbulenten Flug ins Ungewisse.
Wir wollen hier gerne der ESA und der DASA attestieren, dass besonders in der Telekommunikation die europäische Raumfahrt ihren Sinn hat, denn auch NTV kommt über Astra. Und auch Astra wäre nicht am Himmel ohne Sie. Deswegen sind wir da mit in einem Boot.
Um in Kourou die Zuverlässigkeit der europäischen Trägerrakete belegen, doch der Countdown verlief ins Leere. Der Grund? Eine der beiden Stützen konnte nicht weggeklappt werden. Der Computer stoppte den Startvorgang. Die Ariane sollte einen Fernmeldesatelliten ins All befördern. Auch zwei kleine britische Militärsatelliten waren an Bord. Für die Europäische Raumfahrtbehörde ESA war dieser 64. Start wegen wichtiger Folgeaufträge besonders bedeutend. Bereits im Januar war wegen einer mangelhaft funktionierenden Turbopumpe die Ariane während des Starts ins Meer abgestürzt.
Und das ist schon Raumfahrtgeschichte. Das war noch vor meiner Geburt. Die Original-Apollo 14-Kapsel. Deutlich sieht man die Beschädigung am Hitzeschild durch den Wiedereintritt in die Erdatmosphäre. Mir imponieren die Astronauten der Apollo 14-Kapsel mächtig. Sie waren echte Pioniere. Was sie damals erfahren haben, darauf können wir uns jetzt stützen. Als Höhepunkt zeigt mir mein Begleiter vom Hersteller Rockwell das Space Shuttle. Im Fernsehen hat es immer so klein gewirkt. Dabei ist es ein riesiges, wundervolles Schiff, das ich ganz großartig finde. Unser Stand von heute. Sogar auf dem Platz des Kommandanten darf ich sitzen. Noch könnte ich es nicht fliegen, aber ich weiß über die Steuerungsfunktionen Bescheid. Aber wenn meine Ausbildung beendet ist, dann wird auch Space Shuttle ein Museumsstück sein. Keiner weiß heute, wie die erste Marsfähre aussehen wird. Aber ich werde alles tun, dass ich sie fliege.
Expected to cost U.S. taxpayers $17.4 billion. International partners, including Japan, Canada, Russia, and the Europeans, would spend $14 billion to finish the project.
When you abandon the space station, you stop 30 years of progress in human spaceflight. When you abandon the space station, you leave the space shuttle as a magnificent flying machine without its original mission. When you abandon the space station, you kill off the last major science project being done with international partners and jeopardize any future cooperative efforts.
In the battle to keep the station alive, NASA Administrator Daniel Golden visited more than 200 House members who said they would vote against the station. He changed some minds.
The space station is the last major science program we have. This is the last ship out of port. We cannot allow it to fail. This is the future. Do we want to be a society that's known for consumption and survival, or do we want to be known as a society that's committed to the future?
The U.S. has agreed to spend $400 million in Russia, building a docking adapter so the shuttle can connect with the Russian Mir space station next year. The long-term plan is to build the station in stages. The first new module would go up in 1997, and NASA expects the 415-ton final station to be finished 5 years later. While critics charge it will cost a total of $71 billion to build and operate the station for 10 years, supporters say it'll be worth it. They say it's a perfect platform to conduct science and technology research, and it'll be a place where former enemies can learn to work together in peace. The Shuttle Columbia made it into orbit on schedule, lifting off through clouds around the Kennedy Space Center.
3, 2, 1. Booster ignition and liftoff. Liftoff of Columbia on a multi-nation research flight.
The crew of 7 astronauts got to sleep until 8 in the morning before getting a picture taken with the traditional cake and putting on flight suits. Now they're orbiting 160 miles above the Earth, setting up the International Microgravity Laboratory inside Columbia's cargo bay. For the next 14 days, they'll conduct biomedical experiments and grow crystals of virus and human enzymes in an effort to help medical researchers find cures for human diseases. The shuttle is loaded with experiments, more than on any previous mission. There are living things aboard, from newts to Japanese Madaka fish, and there are goldfish. There are jellyfish and toads aboard, 500 fruit flies and 11,200 baby sea urchins. The astronauts will be manufacturing metal alloys in near weightlessness as part of their mission. They're using themselves as guinea pigs in medical experiments, including the effects of spending time in a cramped space station on human psychology. The astronauts will work in 2 shifts, 24 hours a day, and they have a surprise event planned on the 25th anniversary of the Apollo 11 moon landing. John Holloman, CNN reporting.
Fähre hob pünktlich um 18.43 Uhr mitteleuropäischer Sommerzeit vom Weltraumbahnhof Cape Canaveral in Florida ab. Zu der 7-köpfigen Besatzung gehört erstmals auch eine japanische Astronautin. Die Mannschaft soll während ihres Aufenthalts über 80 wissenschaftlichen Experimente durchführen. An diesen Experimenten sind 13 Staaten beteiligt und 200 Wissenschaftler haben diese vorbereitet. Dabei geht es vor allem um Tests in der Schwerelosigkeit. Außerdem soll die Auswirkungen starker Strahlenbelastung auf Zellkulturen untersucht werden. Die Astronauten sollen auch besonders reine Kristalle züchten, die dann für die medizinische Forschung gebraucht werden.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Booster ignition and liftoff.
The shuttle is carrying Japan's first woman astronaut and six Americans. Once in orbit, the seven astronauts plan to work on about 80 experiments from 13 countries. Aside from the crew, thousands of fish, newts, and sea urchins are on board. The research mission is scheduled to last 2 weeks.
Die amerikanische Raumfähre Columbia ist vor eineinhalb Stunden in Cape Canaveral zu einem zweiwöchigen Flug ins All gestartet. An Bord des Shuttle ist neben sechs amerikanischen Astronauten erstmals eine Wissenschaftlerin aus Japan. Mehr als 200 Wissenschaftler aus den USA, Kanada, Japan und Europa haben die etwa 80 Experimente zum Verhalten von Material und Leben in der Schwerelosigkeit zusammengestellt. 13 Versuche werden zum ersten Mal in der Geschichte der US-Raumfahrt per Fernbedienung von Wissenschaftlern der Deutschen Forschungsanstalt für Luft- und Raumfahrt in Köln gesteuert. Es ist der 63. Flug einer amerikanischen Raumfähre.
Astronaut Neil Armstrong took that one small step onto the lunar surface. Most people then probably would have predicted there'd be a permanent man colony on the moon by now. Well, today that dream seems as distant as ever, but the dream is alive, as CNN's Don Knapp tells us.
The United States spent $25 billion to put a man on the moon 25 years ago. All it got back was a few rocks. Now space advocates say it's time to return to the moon and collect on the investment.
We could use the resources of the moon to remove poverty on this planet.
At regular meetings over the past 10 years, return to the moon enthusiasts have tried to launch new interest in lunar possibilities.
The only way Earthkind can afford to return to the moon permanently is to use the lunar surface as an orbiting space station.
Or an orbiting power station, beaming back solar energy.
That energy is enough to supply all the world's energy needs pollution-free.
Dan Greenwood says within 10 years, solar collectors the size of the state of New Hampshire could be sending power back to Earth in the form of radar waves.
We'd like to do astronomy from the moon.
Michael Simon's not waiting for government moonshots. His private company will send robots to the moon in 96. He plans to use existing space hardware from the former Soviet Union combined with new U.S. technology.
We'd like to place our own telescope on the moon and then let people around the world subscribe to it over the internet. We could do the same thing with experimental rovers. We could let people rent a rover for an hour or a day or a week and explore the part of the moon of their choice.
By remote control. For those who really must get to the moon, consider the Boeing 747.
The amount of energy necessary to put, say, a 747 in orbit is the same as the amount of energy to send it from New York to Sydney on a normal run. That's correct. The energy requirements aren't that great to going into orbit.
So what's the hang-up?
The hang-up is that we throw away the rockets every time.
Space advocates say today's technology and a trip back to the drawing board could put the U.S. back on the moon. With profits and benefits for all.
Herren, erfolgreiche Weltraummission. Die Europarakete Ariane hat in der vergangenen Nacht einen amerikanischen und einen japanischen Kommunikationssatelliten ins All befördert. Zwischen dem letzten Start und diesem Einsatz lagen nur 21 Tage Vorbereitungszeit. Die Auftragsbücher sind prall gefüllt. Daher sollen auch die nächsten Starts im 3-Wochen-Rhythmus erfolgen. Erfolgreiche Rückkehr. Die russische Soyuz-Weltraumkapsel ist heute planmäßig in Kasachstan gelandet. Die beiden Kosmonauten Afanasyev und Usatschow hatten knapp 6 Monate in der Raumstation Mir gearbeitet.
Mit einem amerikanischen und einem japanischen Satelliten an Bord hob die europäische Trägerrakete um 1.05 Uhr vom Raumfahrtzentrum Kourou in Französisch-Guayana ab. Der Start verlief ohne Komplikationen. Die Mitarbeiter des Raumfahrtzentrums beobachteten den Verlauf des Fluges mit Spannung. Doch bereits nach 20 Minuten hatte die Ariane ihre Mission erfüllt. In 36.000 Kilometern Höhe setzte sie die beiden Fernmeldesatelliten wie geplant ab.
Has successfully deployed two telecommunications satellites into orbit after a launch from French Guiana. Bad weather had delayed liftoff by more than an hour. It was Ariane's 65th rocket launch from the Guyanese installation, but only the second since a mission failure in January, which sent two satellites worth $250 million plunging into the ocean.
Französisch-Guayana ist heute Morgen eine europäische Trägerrakete vom Typ Ariane nach nur 21 Tagen Vorbereitungszeit erfolgreich gestartet. In knapp 36.000 Kilometer Höhe setzte die Rakete dann einen amerikanischen und einen japanischen Satelliten ab. Die sollen dem Telefon- und Funkverkehr und der Ausstrahlung von Fernsehprogrammen dienen. Durch den verkürzten Startrhythmus will das Raumfahrtzentrum die durch das Scheitern eines Fluges zu Anfang des Jahres entstandenen Verzögerungen wieder ausgleichen.
The astronauts completed their first day in space by starting all the 82 experiments jammed into Columbia's International Microgravity Lab. The crew is working in two shifts around the clock. Leroy Chow has been looking at the Japanese goldfish aboard and reports they're happy and healthy, but seem a little bit restless. The shuttle's 500 jellyfish seem to be reacting in about the same way. They look something like figures in a Pac-Man game as they zoom around in weightlessness. This is slime mold. If you look closely, you can see it move from right to left. Its motion in space is important to scientists who want to know how life processes change in space. NASA put a TV camera in Columbia's cockpit for the launch and let us look over the crew's shoulders as the shuttle's solid rocket sent it soaring toward orbit 160 miles above the Earth. Commander Bob Cabana explains how it feels.
This is just after main engine start, and the solid they're going to light off here, and we're going uphill.
The crew will be in orbit for 2 weeks. John Holloman, CNN reporting.
With the latest on the activities aboard the shuttle, CNN's own John Holloman.
John, I must tell you, this is probably the most international mission that NASA has performed in a long, long time. There's equipment from Germany, from the European Space Agency, a Japanese astronaut on board, and it's shift change time aboard Shuttle Columbia right now. Japanese astronaut Chiaki Mukai is beginning her work in the International Microgravity Lab, while the team that's been at work for the past 12 hours is getting ready for bed. Here's a roving tour of Columbia from the laboratory.
Air inlet and exhaust.
Up through a tunnel. Screens. And finally, onto the shuttle's flight deck. The space shuttle is flying with its tail pointing toward the Earth, so to see the ground, the crew has to look out the rear windows up on the flight deck. This is what the Earth looks like today. The orbit takes the shuttle over North Africa frequently. You can see the reddish color of the Sahara Desert as the shuttle passes overhead. Two of the astronauts are from Cleveland. Carl Walls and Don Thomas talked to CNN Cleveland affiliate WEWS this morning.
That's right, Bill. This is something I've been wanting to do since I was about 6 years old. And when I was in high school, there were a lot of scientist astronauts getting selected then, and that's what really motivated me to do my best in science and go on to Case Western Reserve and Cornell University and pursue the PhD degree. You know, one of the great spin-offs of the space program that's sometimes not mentioned is how it motivates kids. When I was a little kid, I got sparked by the space program, and it just propelled me through high school and college and on to get a PhD, and I was constantly excited by it. And I hope what we're doing up here today sparks the imagination of a lot of kids down there on the ground and gets them going through school.
The big news on the mission today, the birth of two newts and three Japanese fish. They're going to be studied to find out how animals born in weightlessness adapt to gravity on Earth when they get home. John?
John Holloman, thanks very much. We'll have to check in about the newts.
Die sieben Wissenschaftler werden in den nächsten 2 Wochen unter anderem das Verhalten von Fischen in der Schwerelosigkeit untersuchen. Die ersten Erfolge der 17. Mission der Columbia ließen nur einen Tag auf sich warten. Bereits am Samstag entdeckte eine japanische Astronautin, dass Wassermolche und Fische Eier abgelegt hatten.
Old Murayama's deputy, Yohei Kono, she'd felt a little dizzy after blastoff, but now felt fine. She hoped for a similarly speedy recovery for Murayama. The telephone link-up was a welcome break in an otherwise tight schedule. The seven astronauts are involved in a 2-week assignment, working on 82 experiments. To improve efficiency, the crew's divided into two 12-hour shifts for non-stop science studies. Among them, slime mold development and an experiment researching calcium loss. The astronauts are not the only live and contented members on board. Four Japanese medaka fish are apparently doing so well, they've laid 3 eggs.
It's been 25 years since man first set out for a walk on the moon, and astronauts aboard the U.S. Space Shuttle Columbia on Saturday paid tribute to those who went before them. The shuttle left from the same launch pad as Apollo 11 did in 1969. The shuttle astronauts say they were inspired by that milestone in the U.S. space program. And astronomers around the world were captivated as the first chunk of Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 smashed into Jupiter. Saturday's collision triggered a 1,000-kilometer-high explosion. It was visible on Earth through telescopes in Spain and Chile. And CNN's Miles O'Brien has details of what's been called a spectacular phenomenon.
Just right to do it.
It appears the kamikaze comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 will go out with a bang, giving astronomers and the rest of us a memorable show.
That's not once in a lifetime. It's once in a millennium.
Astronomers say the first fragment of the shattered comet plunged deep into Jupiter, creating a 3,000-square-mile plume which rose more than 600 miles above the Jovian atmosphere.
So we beat the statistics.
Yeah, we sure
beat
did.
The odds.
Images taken by the orbiting Hubble Space Telescope provide clear evidence of the huge explosion. Comparisons with images shot earlier this week show a distinct dark spot where the comet fragment struck.
You see that black splotch? It was not there the day before. It's a new feature on Jupiter, and we're going to have 20 more of them.
In fact, astronomers say this first fragment was one of the smallest of the 21 distinct pieces of the comet. So when this striking image filled the computer screens in the Hubble's main control room, astronomers immediately went into orbit.
We were, you know, thinking that we're going to have to go in with a microscope and, you know, look, stretch the image as hard as we could to try and pull out anything. And it's just blasting away at us. Unbelievable.
Comet co-discoverers Gene and Carolyn Shoemaker and David Levy celebrated with champagne, the results exceeding their wildest expectations.
Yes, but not our wildest hopes.
It was an unexpected scene. All this week, astronomers were downplaying predictions of a stunning celestial show, fearing a fizzle would leave them all red-faced.
We're not going to have to hide under a flat rock.
Before the first impact, astronomers insisted they didn't need fireworks to do some good scientific work. But now that the Shoemaker-Levy show has opened to rave reviews, they're hopeful they can mix business with pleasure. Miles O'Brien, CNN, Baltimore.
It's Sunday, July 17th, 1994. Welcome to a special late edition. I'm Frank Sesno. On this day in 1969, Apollo 11 was on the way to the moon. Today, we'll step back into history with Alan Shepard, the first American in space, later a moonwalker himself. Then, a look into the future of manned spaceflight, Q&A with astronomer Carl Sagan, and with Daniel Golden, the administrator of NASA, who's in Mission Control in Houston. Later, we'll go around the table with our panel of veteran journalists on the news of the day. And finally, Bruce Morton with the last word on anniversaries of note in space and here on planet Earth.
Frank.
Thanks very much, Gene. Well, it was in July 1969 that Apollo 11 touched down on the moon. It charted a path that would be followed by five subsequent moon landings. One of them, Apollo 14, headed by Alan Shepard, who back in 1961 had become the first American in space. Early this morning at the National Air and Space Museum, before it opened to the public, Shepard and I looked back on those years when there was no limit to the sky. Hard to believe it's been 25 years.
Oh, it really is. It really is. It just seems like it went by overnight. But, you know, it's kind of fun to look back, even though it's 25 years, and remember with great clarity, because it made such an impression on us and everybody else.
Tell us about these guys from Apollo 11.
Well, you know, Apollo 11 was not absolutely guaranteed to be the landing. Apollo 11 was the first attempt to make a landing. You know, we'd done all the preliminaries. We'd done the lunar orbit rendezvous, and we'd done the partial descent, and all those things had been accomplished. The stage was set, but there was no absolute guarantee that these three guys were going to be able to make it on that first trip.
What were they like as people, as explorers?
Oh.
At the time, I mean, they're still around.
Well, of course, they're slightly different personalities, but the one common thread that runs through this crew and other crews is, in those days, everybody was a test pilot. Everybody had a lot of experience doing strange things, going higher and faster than anybody else.
Now, I don't imagine there's a person who would come to this museum and look into this capsule and not think to themselves, my gosh, how did they sit in there for so long?
Well, you know, it's interesting. People just don't, somehow cannot realize how much fun it is to be weightless. You know, they think in terms of lying on their back and pressure points and all this sort of thing. You know, when you're on the way to the moon, you're literally in zero gravity. You're floating around, and it's very, very pleasant. The feeling of being cramped really isn't there at all.
When these astronauts touch down on the moon, that moment, that precise moment, what is your most intense memory?
Well, I think we all immediately had a sigh of relief, because although we felt pretty confident that Neil could land once he could see the surface, we really didn't think it was going to take him to the point where he only had 16 seconds of fuel left. So there was a lot of relief that he'd made it. And then, of course, tremendous elation. I was in the control center in Houston, and the place just went berserk. Just absolute, tremendous sense of pride.
Let's walk upstairs. Once upon a time, this was your home.
Yeah.
Pretty historic home, too.
Well, still looks pretty good. Still looks pretty good. I don't know whether they got any redstones left or not, but I bet we could probably get that thing back up there again. Might even get a little bit higher this time than we did last time. My gosh, how small and puny, and how did you ever do anything in that? And I said, but you know, at the time, it really seemed like a pretty good idea, because, of course, that was state of the art. The thing of which we're the most proud, I'm sure my test pilot colleagues will agree, is the fact that even on the very first flight, just a short 5 minutes or so of weightlessness, we totally demonstrated that the pilot could control this spacecraft.
If I'm not mistaken, that's you, or supposed to be you, sitting
yeah.
in there. What do you make of the likeness?
Well, that's how I looked. That's how I looked 33 years ago.
You remember the moment of takeoff?
Oh, yes, I do. Absolutely. I think, like all astronauts of yesterday and today, are always nervous, is always concerned just prior to liftoff, because that is one of the more dangerous parts of the mission. But it goes away. As soon as that rocket fires, there's so much attention devoted to what's going on inside, what's happening outside. And so the nervousness goes away, although the heartbeat doesn't slow down. It didn't have any problem on my flight. It was just an incredible piece of design in those days. And the periscope out here. We didn't have a window on my flight, so we had to use the periscope to look down at the Earth.
The Apollo console.
We really felt very, very comfortable with the display and with our ability to control it if anything went wrong, and control it when things went right. As soon as we landed, we took instantaneous samples in case something developed that we had to get quickly off the surface of the moon. We brought back approximately 100 pounds of rocks.
Now that's the work part. Now you had a lighter moment too.
Well,
golf club.
Very last thing I did before climbing up the ladder to take off was to put the head of the yarn on there and a couple of golf balls, and took a couple of clumsy swings. The first one, I actually shanked the ball and it rolled into a crater about 40 yards away, which was a rather infamous hole-in-one, I guess you could talk about. Second one, I hit a little more flush. On the Earth, it would have gone maybe 35 or 40 yards. Actually, it went almost 200 yards.
Man of Mercury, there you are.
Oh, who are all those young guys? I don't know as I recognize any of them, do you?
No, I think you've changed very little since then.
Well, hairstyle's a little different, but put on a little bit of weight, but I'll bet that suit would still fit. I'll bet that space suit would still fit.
Over here, the memoriam.
Right.
To Apollo 1. You're very close with Gus Grissom.
Well, of course, Gus, I guess, was, I was closer to Gus than the other two, but obviously we all trained together, we all knew each other. And it was a tragic moment. Gus was saying to Slayton and me, and we were management at that time, saying, hey, this thing isn't put together right. A lot of things don't work. And we were saying, well, Gus, you know, that's fine, don't worry about it.
By the time you launch, we'll have everything fixed. Just make note of what the problems are and we'll get everything fixed. Now that was a mistake.
This was the culmination of your moments in space.
Well, it really was. And it's interesting when you look at this lunar module from a distance, you think, gosh, that thing would never be able to do anything. It just looks like an oversized birdcage wrapped in aluminum foil. But it was a really, really fine machine.
What were your first thoughts as you climbed out there?
Well, I wanted to be sure I didn't slip and fall. The whole gamut of emotions. I remember saying when I stepped down that something to the effect, well, it's been a long way, but we're here. We had a landing radar problem, and it was a ground rule that said if you coming down from, I don't know, 25,000, 30,000, if you didn't have any landing radar by the time you get to 13,000 feet, then you would have to turn around and go back into orbit. You know, once you can see the surface, you can get down from almost anywhere.
Well, Alan Shepard joins us now live in our studio. A few hours after our walk, we saw you there by your Mercury Freedom 7 capsule, that tiny little thing right there to the lunar module. You said as long as you can see the surface, you can land it. We can see Mars from here. Is that where we're next?
I didn't mean quite that far, Frank. What I meant, of course, was the simulation we had of the landing from all points of height or distance or deviation was so good that we had a lot of confidence that visually we could almost accomplish anything.
What did we really get from those moonshots that you participated in?
Well, aside from all the excitement and national pride associated with that type of exploration, we did get a lot of products and services which we sort of take for granted today. I mean, the communication satellites, for example, around the world, instantaneous communications in all frequencies. The tremendous pressure we put on the computer industry back in the 1960s and mid-60s gave us laptop computers today. Sure, we probably would have had them anyway, maybe 5 or 10 years from now, but they're here today because of that tremendous pressure to reduce computers to fit into the nose cone. And then the navigation schemes that we use in all the airplanes around the world today, military and commercial, navigating with great accuracy just like we did back in those days.
Alan Shepard, author of Moonshot, along with Deke Slayton, your new book, Don't Go Away. When we come back, the future. Have we got our space priorities right? And we will be joined by America's leading astronomer and the head of NASA. Just ahead.
Junior has begun his first orbital ride around the Earth.
Roger, zero G, and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous.
And welcome back to Late Edition. 25 years after Apollo 11's moon landing, it's also time to look ahead to our future in space. Joining us now is astronomer Carl Sagan, director of the Laboratory for Planetary Studies at Cornell University. At Mission Control in Houston, NASA Administrator Daniel Golden, also still here in our studios, astronaut Alan Shepard. And I want to remind our viewers, you might want to see our number and jot it down. Give us a call a bit later in the broadcast. Your questions for our guests. Gentlemen, to all of you, we've just had this remarkable discussion and walkabout over at the Air and Space Museum with Alan Shepard. It begs the question, though, if our finest moments in space exploration aren't now memories and in museum and museum pieces. It seems more that we're recording history than making it, or is that unfair, Dr. Sagan?
Well, it's like it's 1505 and you go to the Spanish Nautical Museum and imagine you see some reconstruction of the Santa Maria and you say it's all in museums. No, there's just a little lull, and then the history of sailing ship exploration goes on. And just the same thing is happening now. I mean, the important thing to bear in mind is that Apollo was 99% of political, beat the Russians, nuclear arms race, intimidate other nations, show that you can use nuclear weapons, and 1% everything else.
Alan Shepard might not agree with that, or do you?
Well, of course, a lot of what Carl says is right, but I think we look back with pleasure on the event, certainly, and a lot of national pride because we were able to accomplish that. But then you think, well,
It's because we put a lot of pressure on the computer industry that we have laptops today. It's because we have satellites that we get instant communication around the world. These kind of things are obviously benefits which you can't necessarily predict going in, but they are in fact a product of that energy and that that attention to resource.
Permit me to disagree with my good friend Alan Shepard. Yes, there have been spin-offs, but the question is, do the spin-offs justify the expense? It's like saying, give me $80 billion to put some guys on the moon and I'll throw in a free stickless frying pan.
Well, let's ask that question, pose that question right to Daniel Golden, who joins us from Mission Control. And point of fact, there's a shuttle mission, Shuttle Columbia is up and about now. All of this worth the expense? You're going to say yes, but how do you justify it?
We justify it because as a society, if we try and survive, if all we want to do is consume and live in the present and not lay fertile ground for our children, it will not be the right thing to do. We have to go to the limits, not just in space, but in many other domains. And let me also say that we're getting ready for the next mission. We're not ready to declare where we're going to go. Apollo, we spent 4% of the federal budget to go to the moon, and it was essential. There was a tension between East and West. Now what we have to do is we go to the next step in the solar system, we have to be much more cost effective. We have to work with other nations on this planet. And by all means, we better find an order of magnitude lower cost solution.
As I mentioned,
that's what NASA's doing now.
As I mentioned, the Space Shuttle Columbia is up. We have some live pictures coming back from the shuttle right now, even as we speak, I believe. And it shows the astronauts. This isn't on the shuttle. This is a part of the Earth component. But what we've got now is a news conference, essentially, between the shuttle astronauts and children here on Earth. There you see the astronauts sitting and taking questions. Carl said earlier they were doing experiments with newts up there and other things. Is this where our efforts should be?
I think the most generous thing that you can say is that newt biology is not worth $500 million, which is the cost of this mission. Let me be very clear. There are an extraordinary number of things that come out of the space program which are worth their weight in gold. Communication satellites, meteorological satellites, satellites to monitor the environmental health of the Earth, treaty verification and military reconnaissance satellites.
These are all unmanned projects.
Exactly. Then. Robot missions to the planets, space telescopes that look to the depths of space and tell us something about the origin, nature, and fate of the universe. And all of those, as you correctly say, Frank, don't involve people.
Well, Mr.
The
Golden,
key question is, what do we need people for? And I don't say that there's no answer to that. There may very well be historical or even issues of human safety involved.
Put that question right to Mr. Golden.
Oh, we've talked about it a lot. How you doing, Dan?
I'm doing just fine. I've talked to Carl about this quite a bit. We have a program that has balance. You cannot prepare for the next step without human beings.
But how do you, what do you say to your critics, Mr. Golden, if I may jump in, that manned flight and space exploration is on an order of magnitude of anywhere from 10 to 100 times the cost of unmanned flight, because you need all the backup systems, all the precautions that unmanned flights don't need.
Let's put a little light on this subject and take a little passion and emotion out of it. Right now, NASA is planning to spend roughly 30% of its budgets on robotic scientific flight. At the end of the planning period, we'll spend about 38% of our budget on human spaceflight. It's not a factor of 10. It's not a factor of 100. We have a program that's focused on the future. If we want to shut down human spaceflight, we're going to lock the people onto planet Earth. It's wonderful to do science, but there's more than just the scientists performing analysis. There is the future. There are the children that you saw there. There is the hope and expectation of humankind.
Alan Shepard, where do you come down on this, Alan Shepard?
Well, I think there has to be a combination of manned and unmanned. I mean, for example, look at the job the boys did with the Hubble telescope. Even though it was operating at some 85% efficiency, it jumped up to 100% because
that couldn't have been done without
because
men
of their
up there,
isn't
that right?
Not only the guys that actually did it, but the guys on the ground that developed the concepts and the way to go up there. So you're always going to have that, even when you're looking back toward planet Earth from the space station in the future.
How about going to Mars?
Times that you're going to need judgment.
How about going to Mars?
Oh, I don't think we're ready to go to Mars yet. We don't even know what kind of propulsion we're going to use yet.
I'm a big enthusiast about going to Mars, despite what I've just been saying. I mean, consider 1961. 1961, the president, President Kennedy, makes a speech saying that we're going to use alloys not yet invented, rocket propulsion systems not yet built, rendezvous and docking techniques that nobody understood, to go to the moon that we had not yet even sent a robot probe to, at a time when not one American had orbited the Earth, only Allen had done a suborbital flight, and we were going to do it by the end of the decade, and by golly, we did it. Now, that is an extraordinary accomplishment. Now, if we could do that, we can easily go to Mars if we had the comparable devotion and motivation.
Alan Shepard, you just mentioned repairing Hubble, and we have a picture from Hubble of one of the stories of the day. The story of the day being this phenomenal development we're witnessing of the comet smashing into Jupiter. Anybody here, tell us what the significance of this picture that we're now seeing is and the phenomenon that's taking place on Jupiter. Mr. Golden, you want to go first?
Yes. I think that all of us have a fascination with planetary encounters. It has changed life on this planet time after time after time. So there's just the human fascination, let alone the scientific discovery we're going to make as
to
the composition of Mars.
What are we going to learn about Jupiter?
Jupiter, I should say. Well, we'll have some understanding of the composition of the material in the environment, how it's layered, how it's structured, but we cannot predict the results. And I'd like not to give you instant science. Let's leave that to the scientists as they go through their analysis.
Okay, but Carl Sagan, you were saying before the program that we should be watching this development with special interest here on Earth.
Well, it is the impact of Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 with Jupiter is a reminder that planets get hit by worldlets, by interplanetary debris, some of which are very substantial. 65 million years ago, a 10-kilometer-wide object slammed into the Earth, and the evidence is now very persuasive that that was the cause of the extinction not only of the dinosaurs, but of 75% of the species of life then on Earth. That means we had better pay some attention to this. The prospects, according to the knowledge we have of who's around in interplanetary space, are the chance of a civilization threatening collision with the Earth in the next century is 1 chance in 1,000. Now, that's very high odds. You wouldn't fly on an airplane with 1 in 1,000 chance of going down, or at least most people wouldn't. And the only way to learn about that, much less to do something about it, is via the kind of things that NASA is involved with. NASA has very practical applications.
On that cheery note, we're going to take a break, but we will guarantee you that we will be back. No comet smashing into us between now and then. Up next, your phone calls for our guests on the future of space exploration. Stay with us.
The vast loneliness up here on the moon is awe-inspiring, and it makes you realize just what you have back there on Earth. The Earth from here is a grand oasis in the big vastness of space.
One, zero, all engine running. Liftoff, we have a liftoff, 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
Back on Late Edition now with our guests talking about the present and future of space exploration. We want to go right to the phones and get our viewers involved in our discussion now. Our first phone call comes from Menden, New Jersey, with a call for Mr. Golden. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon. With limited financial resources, aren't there far more cost-effective means to advance technology than sort of relying on spin-off technologies that is always the argument put forth by our space technology leaders? Thank you.
Not from this space technology leader. The purpose of the space program is to explore the space frontier, not for tech transfer. If you wanted to do tech transfer, you shouldn't have a space program. We are focusing on 10 and 20 and 30 years out with knowledge, inspiration, learning. And if in the process we have tech transfer, then we have a space program.
Is that why you're reproducing newts up in space? Where's the science there?
The science in newts is to understand reproductive activities in space. If we're going to have flights to other planets, we're going to have to understand how we have closed form solutions, how we could not just bring a tremendous amount of food with us, but generate it as we go along.
Dr. Sagan is shaking his head here.
I hate to disagree with Dan because he is the most visionary and effective NASA administrator in a long time, but I think going up for a few days to a week in low Earth orbit and breeding newts for $500 million is not the most effective use of space technology. It's not the most effective use of human missions.
What do you think they should
be doing? We should be planning to go to other worlds. That's what exploration is. If Mars had been in orbit around the Earth instead of the Moon, we would have never had any trouble, because Mars is a world of an atmosphere, of ancient running water, the possibility of past life, dust storms. It has its own moons, polar caps. It's a world of wonders.
Okay,
Frank, I'd like to come back. Look, the people have picked up on the newts because it's popular. It's one of 80 experiments we're performing. We are not spending $500 million on newts.
Okay,
we have a broad range of activity going on there. So, Carl, maybe you don't have the right data, but please don't say we're spending $500 million on newts.
Let's go back to our telephone callers. Columbus, Ohio, go ahead with your question, please.
Yes, my name is William Schubert. I'm a great fan of everyone there. But Dr. Sagan, it seems to me that there are a lot of people like myself who want to see manned missions because they give our young minds, our young scientific minds, a boost, something to shoot for, and heroes. Why do you believe that we should remove that one last incentive to science education? Remember what happened to education after the Apollo missions ended?
I'm a big supporter of science education. And I agree that science in space is a motivator for young people, especially if they could be involved in some way. But the question is, what is the most effective way to use limited resources to pump science education in America? This isn't it. And it isn't even the most effective way to use space to pump science education. Robotic missions to other worlds is a much better way that NASA does much less effectively.
A phone call for Alan Shepard now from West Hurley, New York. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, how you doing?
Good.
Alan, I went on roller coasters before. I was quite nervous and everything. I was wondering how nervous you were when you first started.
Well, Wes, I think everyone's nervous when they're getting ready to lift off or they're getting ready to land on the moon. And it's primarily because even though they've gone through hours in the simulators and practice for all kinds of emergencies, the nervousness is there because you might make some kind of a mistake and ruin your entire day. But once the engine's lighted, you're looking at so many things, you're not nervous anymore.
Gentlemen, we're going to take a break. We'll be back with some final thoughts from our guests right after this.
5, 4, we've gone for main engine start. We have main engine start. Shuttle, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
Wow. After the first steps of the moon, has NASA become lost in space? Deep budget cuts and a very public disaster almost scuttled the space program. With memories of past triumphs fading, America may no longer have stars in its eyes. Can NASA ever live up to the Apollo legacy? CNN presents on CNN International.
For a final few moments with our guests. Mr. Golden, to you first, some final thoughts here.
Yes. Exploration is the sustenance of life. As a society, we could sit and watch TV, and I have nothing against TV, Frank, but we've got to grow and we have to do bold and risky things with robots, with human beings, to inspire, to understand, and blaze the future, and that's what NASA is going to do.
Dr. Sagan.
I completely agree. We come from hunter-gatherers. We were wanderers for 99.9% of our history. Just the last 0.1% of our history, we've been in cities. And the natural thing to do is to extend the human presence elsewhere. This age will be remembered when all of the political things that you mostly spend time on is consigned to dusty archives, as the age when the human species for the first time set foot, robots and humans, in space. It is a major aspect of our history.
And you are one of those humans in space and on the moon.
And I think these discussions are great. There has to be the right balance between manned and unmanned. And of course, the combination of the two we've already seen between the shuttle and the Nimbus, for example, how they're helping each other out. There are all kinds of examples that we will
will generate when we're looking back at planet Earth between the space station and the Earth-bound experiments.
People are going to need to dig deep into their pockets, though, to keep this exploration going one way or the other.
It's still a small percent of our national budget, though, Frank, and it keeps a lot of people gainfully occupied.
Okay, to our guests, Daniel Golden in Houston, to Alan Shepard and Carl Sagan, thanks very much. Alan Shepard, one final thing. I understand that this stuff, which you took into space, has great meaning to you. We wanted to present this to you. You loved this, didn't you?
Oh, I love this stuff. You want to taste, Carl?
No, thanks.
We will turn our attention to the day's news here on planet Earth as we bring on our panel of veteran journalists as we go around the table. Stay with us.
Space Shuttle Commander Bob Cabana has been giving interviews to children's TV shows this weekend, and this afternoon he gave a video answer to one of the most asked questions. How do you go to the bathroom in weightlessness?
The towels that you see here, we don't have a clothesline, and towels are wet. You can't snow them wet, so we put them in those rubber suction cups to let them dry out. Kids always ask, well, how do you go to the bathroom? I tell them, just like you do on Earth, we just have those little restraints on the side to keep from floating off the seat.
That's the answer. The space shuttle crew was given orders to blast off for the moon earlier today. It was an order which came on the 25th anniversary of the Apollo 11 moon launch, but sadly the shuttle doesn't have enough fuel to make that trip. The astronauts are remembering Mike Collins, Neil Armstrong, and Buzz Aldrin, as is CNN's John Zarella.
The weather is certainly go. It's a beautiful morning for a launch to the moon.
The morning of July 16, 1969, was like none other in history. Three astronauts, Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, and Michael Collins, sat atop a 363-foot Saturn V rocket. Their next stop would be the moon.
Then I could look out, see the sun coming up, see all the cars out, the waves slowly rolling in. Everything at a distance, you know, has a degree of peace and serenity. And here's this rocket with the steam and the frost coming off of it. And it was just a wonderful, memorable moment that I wanted to be etched in my mind.
8 years of preparation had gone into this moment. The technical and emotional strength of a nation had been summoned to answer a president's challenge.
All the second stage tanks now pressurized, 35 seconds and counting. We are still go with Apollo 11.
Now, the United States was standing on the precipice of the greatest adventure in history. Thousands of people, thousands of reporters crammed Cocoa Beach, Florida. The day before, at a pre-launch news conference, Armstrong was asked if words had been prepared for him to say when he took his first steps on the moon.
Certainly nothing has been prepared for me, and our attention during the training period and up till now has been focused on how to do the job and how to do it best.
For centuries, the moon had beckoned, and mankind was finally ready to answer.
Neil Armstrong reported back when he received the good wishes, "Thank you very much. We know it will be a good flight. Good luck and Godspeed." Ignition sequence start. 6.
That moment, as this is coming to life, it's like a birth. Under these dramatic conditions, it was always a very pleasing thing to see, but great tension also prevailed.
Neil Armstrong reporting the roll and pitch program, which puts Apollo 11 on a proper heading.
3 hours later, the vehicle left Earth's orbit. In 4 days, Armstrong, Aldrin, and Collins would rendezvous with history. John Zarella, CNN, reporting.
Strolling on the moon one day in the merry, merry month of December.
May. Gene Cernan could never have fathomed the possibility 22 years ago that he could be the last man on the moon.
I really thought we'd learn from having gone to the moon and we'd begin to do bigger and better things. We didn't, quite frankly. We didn't.
The mammoth Saturn V rockets were turned into museum pieces, and the technology that sent humans to the moon was abandoned.
If you say, I'd like to go there next year or two, it'd be a problem. It'd really be a problem. We probably don't even have the documentation or the tooling to go build those engines that we use, for example.
The spaceships men from Earth fly in have certainly come a long way.
since Gene Cernan, Harrison Schmitt, and Ron Evans flew the last moon mission in this Apollo 17 command module. While the shuttle is an engineering marvel, many in the space program fear it fails to capture the human spirit.
As a kid, I used to marvel at a train. You know, I used to marvel at a train. Today, a train stops me at a railroad crossing, and I don't marvel anymore. I'm irritated. Airplane flies over today, a jet airliner. 747 flies over today or whatever. I don't look up anymore. Well, that's where we are in the shuttle business.
It is perhaps unfair to compare anything before or since to the Apollo era. It stands alone as a serendipitous event along the timeline of human history.
When a quarter of a century ago, we not only journeyed a quarter of a million miles away in the space, we literally lived on another, if you will, world in this universe. That's a startling statement. I'm sure people 100 years from now are going to look back and say, you know, what did those people do? And that's why I say maybe Apollo truly came before its time.
John Zarella, CNN, reporting.
Bemerkt, haben Sie es etwa gespürt, was vergangene Nacht wieder auf dem Jupiter passiert ist? Der achte Einschlag eines Kometenstückes hat die bisher hellste Explosion auf dem Planeten hervorgerufen. Ein 10-minütiges Feuerwerk aus gigantischen Lichtblitzen war zu beobachten. Der Einschlag erzeugte eine rund 15.000 Kilometer hohe Druckwelle. Auch unser japanischer Wissenschaftsfreund Sekiguchi hat diesmal alles mitbekommen. Sie erinnern sich, an Samstag, da hat der gute Mann den ersten Aufschlag wegen seiner Teepause verpasst. Der Weltraum beherrscht dieser Tage also wieder die Schlagzeilen. Da trifft es sich gut, dass die amerikanische Weltraumbehörde NASA morgen das 25-jährige Jubiläum des ersten bemannten Mondfluges feiert. Die Helden von damals, Armstrong, Aldrin und Collins, werden überall wieder gefeiert. Doch wer kennt noch den Astronauten, der als bislang letzter Raumfahrer den Mond betreten hat? Sein Name ist Harrison Schmitt. Er war heute in Hamburg. Andrea Thilo hat ihn beobachtet.
I would love to go to the moon again. I'd like to take you with me.
22 Jahre nach seinem Abenteuer im All kann sich Harrison Schmitt über mangelnden Rummel nicht beklagen. Der heute knapp 60-Jährige hat ohne Probleme den Weg zurück ins irdische Leben geschafft. So problemlos wie kaum einer seiner mondfahrenden Kollegen. Schmitt war der erste Wissenschaftler auf dem Mond. Als Geologe sei er eben zur rechten Zeit am rechten Ort gewesen, sagt er. Und so fast zufällig zum Astronauten der Apollo-17-Mission geworden. Je weiter er damals die Erde hinter sich ließ, umso näher kam er ihr. Die Erde ist auch auf dem Mond allgegenwärtig und zieht unsere Aufmerksamkeit an. Nicht nur ein schöner Lichtblick im tiefschwarzen All, sondern vor allem auch als Heimat. 22 Stunden tourte Schmitt mit seinem Kollegen Cernan außerhalb der Raumfähre über die Lava. Angst habe er bei seiner Mission nie empfunden. Schließlich hätte eine 500.000 Menschen jahrelang daran gearbeitet, dass alles gut geht. Fast alles. Mich hat nur eins beschäftigt, dass mein frischer weißer Raumanzug keine Flecken bekam, bevor die Fernsehkameras aufgestellt wurden. Die Anziehungskraft auf dem Mond ist nur ein Sechstel so groß wie auf der Erde. Da wurde die Spritztour im Raumfahrtmobil fast zum Flug übers Geröll und der Astronaut auf der Suche nach Gesteinsproben zum Kind. Außer dem Wunsch, das Rätsel um die Entstehung dieses Himmelskörpers zu lösen, plagte den Kosmonauten auch schon mal ganz Irdisches. Wenn ich dort oben überhaupt was vermisst habe, dann war es scharfes Essen. Aber wegen der Sache mit der körperlichen Entsorgung war gutes Essen tabu.
But you still miss it. Your palate misses the good food.
Schmitt war 72 zwar der Letzte auf dem Mond, aber die Welt guckte vor allem fasziniert auf die ersten drei Jahre vorher. Neil Armstrong und Edwin Aldrin, die Pioniere. $2 Milliarden kostete allein die Live-Übertragung die amerikanischen Steuerzahler. Dafür wurden sie Zeuge, wie ihr Sternenbanner dort nun auf alle Zeiten weht und wie Präsident Nixon seine tiefe Verbundenheit ausdrückt aus 400.000 Kilometer Entfernung. Seit dieser gelungenen Rückkehr zur Erde sind die Visionen von damals noch größer geworden. Schmitt, der ehemalige Astronaut und zwischenzeitliche Senator, träumt vom Mond als künftigem Energielieferanten und davon, Mars und Mond auf Dauer zu besiedeln. Das wird sehr wichtig werden, nicht nur als Lösung unseres Energieproblems, sondern auch um das Überleben der menschlichen Spezies zu garantieren. Diese riesigen Bagger sollen dann tausende Tonnen Mondgestein abbauen, darin reichlich Helium. Das kostbare Gut soll auf Mutter Erde in Energie umgewandelt werden. Strom vom Mond. Eine kühne Vision von einem, der vom Mond einfach nicht lassen kann.
Nicht einen, sondern gleich mehrere Lichtblitze am linken unteren Rand des Jupiter zeigten die ersten Bilder, die kurz nach 22 Uhr von der Sternwarte auf dem spanischen Berg Cala Alto übermittelt wurden. Die Astronomen vermuten nun, dass die beiden Q-Elemente, so die offizielle Bezeichnung, mehrere Brocken im Schlepptau hatten. Anderen Interpretationen zufolge könnten die Q-Elemente vor ihrem Sturz auf den Jupiter in mehrere Teile zerfallen sein. Dennoch sind die Astronomen nicht enttäuscht. Die Aufschläge seien schlimmer als erwartet, meinen Sie, man könne nur hoffen, dass so etwas nicht auf der Erde passiert.
Wir sehen zu, wie die Granaten das letzte Lächeln der Kinder in Bosnien zerfetzen. Und wir sehen zu, wie sich 1 Million verdurstende Menschen von Kugeln gehetzt durch die glühende Steppe Afrikas schleppen. Wir fällen die letzten Riesen unserer Regenwälder, um sie als Fensterrahmen zu verhökern. Und wir schießen mit Spraydosen den einzigen Schutzschild der Raumschiff Erde weg, um uns die eigene Haut vor der Ozonbombe retten zu können. Und dann kommt da ein Stein aus den Tiefen der Ewigkeit geflogen und reißt ein Loch in unseren Nachbarplaneten Jupiter, nicht mal eine kosmische S-Bahn-Station von uns entfernt. Wäre dieser Stein auf dem Planeten Erde gefallen, alle Lichter wären längst für immer erloschen. Gott würfelt nicht, hat Einstein gesagt und gemeint, nichts im Universum ist Zufall, alles Mathematik und damit vorausberechenbar. Aber manchmal wirft Gott einen Stein. Um uns, um unsere schicksalhafte Abhängigkeit von unserem Universum zu erinnern. Um uns vor unserem Hochmut zu warnen, mit dem wir unser Raumschiff Erde auf Verschleiß fahren. Um uns zu warnen vor der Wichtigtuerei der Herzlosigkeit, mit der wir miteinander umgehen. Zu warnen vor der Verschwendung der Zeit, die er uns geschenkt hat, die doch weniger ist als ein Wimpernschlag der Ewigkeit.
Soweit der Kommentar von Martin Mirsch.
3 explosive fireballs within a small area and unique chemical reactions could follow.
So stuff thrown up from Jupiter by the impact, electrons, electrified particles, zoom up the magnetic lines of force and fall down on the other end of Jupiter, hit the molecules there, make the air glow. That's the northern lights of Jupiter.
Scientists say the spots on Jupiter should be easy to see, even for amateurs with backyard telescopes.
Die 3 Apollo 11 Astronauten Neil Armstrong, Michael Collins und Edwin Buzz Aldrin ehrte Clinton als Pfadfinder zum Unvorstellbaren in jener Zeit. Sie hätten damals den Traum einer Nation erfüllt und gezeigt, dass nichts unmöglich ist. Der Mond vor 25 Jahren. Neil Armstrong kommentierte den ersten Kontakt mit den legendären Worten: Dies ist ein kleiner Schritt für einen Menschen, aber ein Riesensprung für die Menschheit. Ein Fünftel dieser Menschheit, allein 24 Millionen Deutsche, verfolgte die ersten Mondhüpfer vor dem Bildschirm. Einer von ihnen war der heutige Arbeitsminister Norbert Blüm.
Ich habe es gesehen im Bett, also ich lag im Bett, wie ich weiß. Und ich fand es aufregend. Vielleicht würde ich mich heute schon gar nicht mehr so aufregen. Vielleicht sind wir auch heute schon gegenüber diesen Wundern viel zu abgebrüht. Es war nämlich ein Wunder. Und den Mann im Mond kannte ich nur vom Märchen. Jetzt war der Film kein Märchen, sondern eine reale Reportage, live. Starke Nummer.
Bad weather at the landing site in Florida prevented the astronauts from coming home on time. The delay makes the mission the longest shuttle trip ever. And the longest U.S. space flight in more than 20 years. Columbia is now scheduled to land at 10:38 GMT, and CNN International plans to provide live coverage. North America, eastern seaboard wet, west coast dry, in between some scattered storms.
Im Laufe von knapp einer Woche sind bis zu 25 Trümmer auf den Jupiter gehagelt. Sie entfachten dort Lichtblitze, Gaspilze und Explosionen mit der Energie von Millionen Hiroshima-Bomben. Entgegen früherer Erwartungen konnten von den meisten Einschlägen hervorragende Fotos gemacht werden. Die Astronomen erhoffen sich von den Auswertungen detailliertes Wissen über den Aufbau des größten Planeten in unserem Sonnensystem. Aus den Beobachtungen wollen sie neue Erkenntnisse über die Verhältnisse auf der Erde gewinnen. Direkte Folgen auf unser Leben hat das planetarische Spektakel aber nicht.
The two-week science mission was supposed to have ended on Friday. The bad weather at the landing site in Florida prevented Columbia from returning home on time. The delay makes the mission the longest shuttle trip ever and the longest U.S. space flight in more than 20 years. Columbia is now scheduled to land at 10:38 GMT. That's about 30 minutes from now. CNN International plans to provide live coverage.
In a few seconds, Commander Bob Cabano is taking control, steering Columbia. He'll be steering it in its final approach and down the runway on Florida's east coast. Cabano is making a wide right turn right now and is approaching the runway from the north. This allows Columbia's speed to slow even more. The sun will come up, we are told, at the very moment Columbia touches down, and as you can see, it's a beautiful morning on the Florida coast. This mission has made history in lots of ways. The first Japanese woman is aboard, and the crew of seven has worked in two shifts, 24 hours a day, to conduct 82 different science experiments, more than on any previous shuttle flight. The shuttle now in its final approach. After touchdown, we'll watch as Columbia rolls to a stop on the Kennedy Space Center runway.
5,000 feet.
Until about a half hour ago, the astronauts were nearly weightless. But right now, they're feeling their full weight for the first time in 2 weeks. We're listening to the voice of NASA commentator Kyle Herring, who says that pilot Jim Halsell is about to lower the landing gear. We'll watch and listen.
The landing gear is now down. Main gear touchdown. And nose gear touchdown. Columbia completing its 17th voyage in space, completing 236 orbits of the Earth. Rolling out on runway 33 at the Kennedy Space Center, completing 6,143,000 miles.
More than 6 million miles of travel in 15 days. Two of the crew members have gone through some unusual procedures to make the return to gravity easier. Rick Heeb and Chiaki Mukai spent extra time in a bag which pulls body fluids from the upper body into their legs. They will be reporting within the next 5 or 10 minutes on how they feel compared to other crew members who didn't go through these special procedures in the bag. And later today, the astronauts will have a news conference while their memories of the flight are still fresh. That's a first for a shuttle mission, letting the astronauts talk to reporters this soon after a flight. There's a camera in the cockpit which has recorded exactly what has happened from the pilot.
Excellent, excellent job. Your record of 15 days on orbit for the shuttle has brought us closer to the next giant leap for humankind when we live permanently in space aboard the International Space Station.
Well, thank you, Charlie. It's great to be home. We're all feeling great, and it was a super flight, and thanks to everybody for all the fine help.
And Bob, the ship's in great shape. There's no deltas to your post-landing.
Roger, no landings, and we're in the post-landing checklist.
One more long checklist for the astronauts as they go through and turn off the lights and the other switches.
The crew of Columbia is now stepping into the post-landing procedures.
I read you loud and clear.
Those procedures include making contact with the convoy team that will service the orbiter.
Well, as you can see, Columbia sitting there on the runway. They say there are no problems with the orbiter that have shown up on computers at Mission Control. NASA says we're going to get to see these pictures from the cockpit camera that we talked about later today. We'll stop for Shuttle Columbia. Next mission, by the way, scheduled to begin on August 18th, when an international radar lab, which flew aboard Shuttle Endeavour in the spring, returns to map almost all the Earth's surface in the summertime. That's it for CNN Special Columbia landing coverage. We now return you to our regular programming.
This has been a CNN Live event.
Wieder zu den Kontrollräumen bringen werden. Sie werden wahrscheinlich
medizinisch untersucht, aber es scheint so, dass auch dass dieses Mal wirklich auch im All keine größeren Probleme aufgetreten sind. 82 Experimente haben die Wissenschaftler ausgeführt, darunter auch ein Experiment mit Wassermolchen, Goldfischen und Quallen. Es dreht sich nun dabei auch darum, wie diese Tiere den Wiedereintritt in die Erdatmosphäre bewältigen werden. Nachdem diese Landung so glücklich abgelaufen ist, beenden wir unsere Live-Übertragung aus Cape Canaveral und machen weiter mit Nachrichten bei NTV in Berlin.
The U.S. space shuttle Columbia has made it safely back to Earth after 15 days in space. The shuttle touched down at Florida's Kennedy Space Center Saturday morning, carrying its 7 astronaut crew that were conducting more than 80 experiments while in space. Most of the experiments centered on how organisms reproduce, develop, and adapt in space. On Friday, bad weather conditions had delayed the shuttle's landing, making it the longest U.S. space flight in more than 20 years. The Shoemaker-Levy comet has ended its death dive on planet Jupiter and left many wondering what would happen if a comet wandered into a collision path with our planet. CNN's Miles O'Brien reports.
It's not Hollywood quality, but this short movie tells the story. When one of the largest of the Shoemaker-Levy 9 dive bombers, Fragment G, plowed into the planet Jupiter, it kicked up a mushroom cloud 1,000 miles above the atmosphere, the scene reminiscent of a nuclear explosion.
The wealth of information is going to come from the combination and combining all the results, and it's unprecedented. This is just food for astronomers and scientists for years.
And that is just an appetizer. This is a close overhead view of the Earth-sized bruise left behind by Fragment G. It's part of a series of new images showing the violent aftermath of the week-long assault on the solar system's largest planet. Ultraviolet telescopes are getting a better view of the dark material kicked up by the comet pieces. It appears to be spreading in Jupiter's windy upper atmosphere.
These big black splotches are not holes in the clouds. They're not waves. They're mostly dark particles and also some UV-absorbing gases that appear on Jupiter's atmosphere.
Astronomers aren't sure how long the evidence of this comet catastrophe will linger, but the rumblings on Jupiter may have caused some lingering concern about our own planet. This week, there were renewed calls in Congress to have NASA search our neighborhood of the solar system for asteroids and comets larger than a half mile in diameter.
We think this is indeed a very worthwhile program for NASA to carry out. It is NASA's responsibility, and I think Congress is now asking NASA to go forward with it.
For comet co-discoverers Gene and Carolyn Shoemaker, it is a bittersweet time. They are ecstatic about the way their baby has performed, but they will miss it just the same.
I think I'll always miss the fact that it isn't out there. It was just too much a part of my life for this year and a half, 2 years now. It seems to me I've thought of it night and day, off and on, and I'll miss it.
For astronomers, there won't be much time for sadness. They now must sift through a mountain of data they are certain contains new revelations about the ingredients of Jupiter's mysterious atmosphere and the behavior of dive-bombing comets. Miles O'Brien, CNN, Greenbelt, Maryland.
Columbia has landed in Florida a day behind schedule. The astronauts broke an endurance record, remaining in space more than 14 days and 18 hours. The shuttle was supposed to land Friday, but couldn't because of storms in Florida.
Columbia is back after its 15-day journey in space. The shuttle and its 7-person crew glided to touchdown at Florida's Kennedy Space Center at sunrise Saturday. Shuttle communicator Charlie Procure says the mission moved the U.S. space program closer to one of its goals, living permanently aboard a space station. The flight team, including Japan's first woman astronaut, had conducted more than 80 experiments. The shuttle's landing was delayed by foul weather Friday, making it the longest U.S. space flight in more than 20 years.
Erfolgreicher Abschluss eines Rekordfluges. Die US-Raumfähre Columbia hat die bisher längste Shuttle-Mission hinter sich gebracht. 15 Tage lang war sie im All. Die Landung musste wegen Gewittern um einen Tag verschoben werden. Die 7 Besatzungsmitglieder, darunter eine Frau, haben 82 wissenschaftliche Experimente in der Schwerelosigkeit absolviert.
Um 12.38 Uhr mitteleuropäischer Zeit setzte Columbia auf Landebahn 33 in nördlicher Richtung im Kennedy-Raumfahrtzentrum Cape Canaveral in Florida auf. Eine Bilderbuchlandung. Über Funk dickes Lob für die Besatzung. Diese Mission, so die NASA, bedeutet einen großen Schritt auf dem Weg zu einer ständig bemannten internationalen Raumstation.
12.38 Uhr landete sie auf dem Weltraumbahnhof Cape Canaveral im US-Bundesstaat Florida. Wegen schlechten Wetters war die Landung um einen Tag verschoben worden. Dadurch wurde die Mission zum Rekordflug. Nach 15 Tagen im All war es der längste Flug einer amerikanischen Raumfähre. Nur eines von 82 geplanten Experimenten wurde nicht durchgeführt. Die sieben Astronauten umkreisten an Bord der Columbia 236 Mal die Erde. Dabei legten sie fast 10 Millionen Kilometer zurück.
Schlechtes Wetter hatte die Landung gestern verhindert. Dadurch geriet der Flug der Columbia zur längsten Mission einer Raumfähre im All. An Bord waren sieben Astronauten. Zum ersten Mal war auch eine japanische Wissenschaftlerin im All.
While the Space Agency helped develop much of the high technology the rest of the world uses, NASA engineers are just now getting their hands on some of it. Why the delay? Cinderella went on a mission to find out.
When the cameras switched to mission control in Houston during a shuttle flight, the room, its hardware and software, is the same as it was when men first landed on the moon. Ironically, some newer technology inspired by the moon missions is only now being utilized by NASA.
We helped develop the technology that then spawned an entire revolution in personal computers and faxes and other things. And now that technology has come back home to us when we need it the most so we can reduce the cost of space operations.
One way to reduce the cost was to do away with the antiquated chip and wire control center and replace it with this super sophisticated 21st century facility. Instead of running up huge design costs to build systems specifically for NASA, this control center uses commercial off-the-shelf products, easy to install and simple to replace.
This unit fails within about 10 minutes, I can have a new unit installed and be up and running again.
The cost of the new control center is $230 million, but by its high-tech nature, the facility is far less expensive to maintain and operate and far more versatile. Both the space shuttle and space station, when it is built, can be operated from this single room.
With this control center architecture that we have here today, we can run both the shuttle and station programs operations for 200 people less than it takes to run the shuttle operations over in the old building today.
With joint U.S.-Russia missions becoming integral to NASA's future, the system is even capable of computer displays in the Russian language. Right now, it would be easy to trace the paper trail for any missions at NASA. Thousands of pages of schematic drawings, flight rules, and crew procedures are needed. That's going away, too.
We're trying to remove the paper environment, the paper-intensive environment of the old control center, by moving some of our flight documentation into electronic imaging.
During the next few years, the old center will be phased out. By 1997, when the space station is going into orbit, the new mission control will be ready to take over. John Zarella, CNN, at the Johnson Space Center in Houston.
Insgesamt 24 Kometentrümmer, die nach dem Zeitpunkt ihrer Einschläge durchbuchstabiert wurden, waren in der vergangenen Woche in die Jupiteratmosphäre gerast und dort explodiert.
Das Kometenfragment L erzeugte einen riesigen Feuerball und schlug einen Krater in die Jupiteratmosphäre, dessen Durchmesser doppelt so groß wie die Erde ist. Ein paar Stunden später, nach dem Einschlag des Trümmers R, entdeckten die Astronomen Wasser, das wahrscheinlich vom Jupiter stammt. Die Sterngucker schwärmen von fantastischen Bildern und nennen diesen Kometenhagel ein Jahrhundertereignis. Schon vor der Auswertung der Daten meinen die Forscher, ihr Wissen über Kometen verdoppelt und ihre Erkenntnis über den größten Sonnenplaneten Jupiter enorm vermehrt zu haben. Als Nebeneffekt der brillanten Lichtshow der vergangenen Woche erhoffen sich die Astronomen auch Informationen über die Entstehung unseres eigenen Planeten.
Der Einschlag des letzten Kometenfragments, hier eine Computeranimation, bereitet den Wissenschaftlern noch Kopfzerbrechen. Heute, kurz nach 10 Uhr, verschwand es im Jupiter. Beobachtbare Lichtblitze gab es keine. Vermutlich ist das Bruchstück des Kometen, genauso wie bereits andere Fragmente auch, einfach ins Innere des Planeten eingedrungen, ohne auf der Jupiteroberfläche sichtbar zu reagieren. Trotzdem, die Wissenschaftler sind begeistert. Diese Aufnahme vom Hubble-Teleskop zeigt die Brandmale auf dem Planeten. Jeder Treffer bietet die Chance zu chemischen Analysen. Einzelne Moleküle konnten bereits identifiziert werden. Das Ergebnis ist eine Sensation. Auf dem Gasplaneten gibt es Schwefel, Ammoniak und sogar Wasser. Ist Leben auf dem Planeten möglich?
Also Leben auf dem Jupiter mit vier Beinen und einer Schnauze existiert ganz sicher nicht und entsteht auch gerade jetzt nicht. Es ist richtig, es wurde Wasser entdeckt. Man muss jetzt herausfinden, ob das Wasser vom Kometen kam oder aus den tieferen Schichten der Jupiteratmosphäre, wo angenommen wird, dass Wasser vorkommt. Das wäre sehr schön, wenn wir das nachweisen könnten.
Durch die von Explosionen hervorgerufene Hitze hat der Jupiter derzeit eine äußerst günstige Temperatur für chemische Prozesse. Erste Spektralanalysen liegen bereits vor. Die wissenschaftliche Auswertung dieser Kurven wird aber noch Jahre dauern. Die Astronomen erhoffen sich unter anderem Erkenntnisse darüber, wie die Sonne, der Jupiter und andere Planeten entstanden sind.
Das interstellare Fieber in Bayern beginnt also abzuebben. Damit ist der Weg frei für die übrigen Nachrichten.
Jupiter gets pounded by a string of comet chunks. A week's worth of cosmic collisions has stirred up the gaseous planet and surprised scientists. Hello and welcome. I'm Miles O'Brien, reporting this week from the Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland. This is where NASA controls the Hubble Space Telescope, which this week played a starring role in the astronomical story of the millennium. I'm referring, of course, to the shattered comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, whose 21-gun salute directly into Jupiter caused quite a stir. Jupiter before and Jupiter after the week that was. The undisputed heavyweight champion of planets bruised and battered after a flurry of punching from the challenger, the 21-piece comet Shoemaker-Levy 9.
Even after you look at the computer models and you sort of know rationally what to expect, I think there's just an element of astonishment in actually seeing it happen in real life.
The real-life excitement for astronomers began last Saturday. After downplaying expectations, astronomers knew the instant they saw the first real image, the kamikaze comet would go out with a bang.
I think we're very, very privileged tonight to see an event that's not once in a lifetime, it's once in a millennium.
The first piece of the shattered comet, called Fragment A, plunged deep into Jupiter, creating a plume which rose more than 600 miles above the Jovian atmosphere.
We beat the statistics.
Yeah, we
beat the odds.
Comet discoverers Gene and Carolyn Shoemaker and David Levy celebrated with champagne, the results exceeding their wildest expectations.
It's a champagne experience.
No one knew what to expect because no one had ever seen anything like it. Fortunately for astronomers, they had a year to plan for a global viewing effort.
It's the first time we've actually observed the solar system body and been able to predict the impact well ahead of time.
Astronomers believe Jupiter's high-tech gravity pulled Shoemaker-Levy into an erratic orbit perhaps 50 years ago. But in July of 1992, the comet got too close for comfort. Jupiter tore it asunder, and this week finally pulled it in for the kill. Astronomers were doing everything they could to catch a glimpse.
Every piece of glass on the Earth is going to be looking at Jupiter at the time. I think it's seldom that we've seen this kind of a global network of observatories all trained on this event.
And so were some observatories which are out of this world. The Galileo space probe, already on its way to Jupiter, is close enough to peek behind the planet and might have captured images of the impacts. But its faulty antenna will delay transmission of those pictures for months. The orbiting Hubble Space Telescope provided the most detailed images of the impact zones, which rotated into Earth view less than a half hour after each collision. Astronomers are hoping the fragments will peel away some of the mysteries of the planet of the gods.
It'll shake the atmosphere down deep and maybe dredge up exotic compounds from down deep. And so we're going to use this comet as a probe of Jupiter's deeper atmosphere.
Scientists were also watching the seismic waves created by the massive comet collisions. Measurements of the speed of those waves may help astronomers understand the structure of Jupiter's permanently obscured core. But this past week, scientists had little time to analyze the mountain of data they have gathered. There was time to marvel at the growing Shoemaker-Levy 9 photo album. They say the scar left by one of the larger fragments, Fragment G, is
the most visually
prominent, discrete spot ever observed on Jupiter.
The massive bruise is larger than the diameter of Earth, an outer crescent on one side reminiscent of a good shiner. Astronomers have an explanation.
These large objects are coming in and splashing into the atmosphere, much like kids jumping off a high dive doing a cannonball. And because it's coming in at an angle, the splash goes off at an angle as well.
It is one large cannonball. Images captured by ground-based telescopes show the intense hot spots created after the comet pieces packed their wallops. Astronomers say Fragment G's blow unleashed 6 million megatons of energy, the force of 500 million Hiroshima bombs, enough to cause a catastrophe here on Earth. But Jupiter is 12 times wider and 300 times the mass of our planet. So once the bruises fade, this gaseous behemoth should be given a clean bill of health. After a week-long battering, Shoemaker Levy 9 has delivered its crowning blows. Four pieces of the shattered comet were spaced perfectly to slam into Jupiter within 60 miles of each other over 20 hours. The real-life rumblings 500 million miles away created some reverberations here on Earth. Astronomers say our planet could just as easily become a bullseye for a comet or asteroid.
Chicken Little was mistaken, but as Shoemaker Levy 9 hitting Jupiter reminds us, there really are these objects in the sky, and they really do hit worlds. No one has ever experienced such a thing here on Earth. That doesn't mean it can't happen.
The collisions have posed many questions astronomers are only beginning to ponder.
The neat thing about this is that the public is getting to see the stuff as soon as we see it as astronomers, and we're all enjoying the gee whiz nature of it, the plumes and the dust clouds spreading out. But the real meat is going to come out over the next months, if not years, in terms of the incredible amount of science we're going to be able to learn from this thing.
Observatories all over the world have opened their doors to the public this week. The lines are long, and the excitement runs deep.
I think they're fascinating. I wish there were a way to experience it a little closer than on television. This is an opportunity for us to see that.
I haven't seen a crowd like this really ever. The only things that have come close are back a few years ago for Halley's Comet.
Now that the show is over, the real work begins for astronomers. They will crunch their numbers and then next spring hold a big meeting to share their new theories about comets and Jupiter. We'll keep you posted. This remarkable comet impact coincided with some other notable events in space, such as the end of the Space Shuttle Columbia's two-week mission. The seven crew members ran 82 different experiments in near-zero gravity. They studied how animals reproduce and develop in space. Newts, goldfish, and fruit flies were all closely watched, and while some creatures died, most survived. The astronauts also examined themselves to learn more about how people adapt to living in weightlessness.
This is Shuttle Launch Control at T-minus 3 hours and holding. We do have live pictures back here at the Kennedy Space Center at Launch Pad 39A. Currently looking at the mobile launcher platform and one of the solid rocket boosters. ICE team is on the zero level of the platform, making inspections, scanning the orbiter vehicle, recording temperatures, and making note of anything that looks unusual. One of the activities the team performs at this level is pulling down of some sensors that are located in between the space shuttle orbiter and the external tank. You can see the lines to those sensors are to the left-hand side of the booster, in between the two boosters. Once the ICE team finishes their inspection, they'll be coming back here to the Launch Control Center, and they'll make a report to launch controllers on their findings at the launch pad. The STS-65 crew has been preparing for about a year for this flight today. Today will be the beginning of their 14 days on orbit. And we have a picture of Bob Cabana now, commander of this flight. Just completed a weather briefing and very optimistic today about today's launch. Cabana is a member of the red team for mission STS-65. STS-65 pilot, Jim Halsell, also a member of the red team, flying for the first time today on the space shuttle. Mission specialist and payload commander for this flight, Rick Hebe. He's flying for the third time today on the space shuttle. He's a member of the red team. He'll be working inside the IML Space Lab as part of the science crew with some primary responsibility for activities going on in flight. And across the room, we've got mission specialist Carl Walls. Ready to go today? Walls is a member of the blue team. Mission specialist Leroy Chow. He's part of the Space Lab science crew. He's flying for the first time today. Mission specialist Don Thomas. Thomas is born in Cleveland, Ohio. He's a member of the blue team, flying for the first time today. And we have Japanese payload specialist Chiaki Mukai. She's making history in Japan as the first woman to fly into space from Japan. Mukai is a member of the red team and also part of the Space Lab science crew. She'll be involved in the science activities going on in the International Microgravity Laboratory for the flight. Commander Bob Cabana, got pilot Jim Halsell.
Good morning. Thank you all. We're going to have a great flight. Thank you.
Flight crew will be making communications checks with the test conductors here at KSC and also at Mission Control. They'll be talking to the flight controllers there.
MS-1, loud and clear. MS-2, loud and clear.
MS-3, loud and clear.
MS-4, loud and clear.
He is one, loud and clear.
Copy, have you loud and clear also, going back there to ground one.
T-minus 8 minutes and counting.
PLT, OTC.
OTC, PLT, that is complete.
Okay, I copy.
NTD Houston flight.
I'll go for it.
Yes, at this time I'd like to give a go for the RTLS weather, both the observed and forecast conditions, and we're go for launch.
I copy, thank you. Launch director. Launch director, NTD 212.
Go ahead.
Yes, sir, flight has cleared his weather constraint, there go, and that puts us fully ready to proceed.
Okay, stand by, and MMP chairman.
Roger, our weather constraint is cleared, cleared to launch.
Okay, copy. Well, with that NTD, you can take out the hold pending at 5 minutes and see if we can keep the clock going for another 7.
TLS copies.
Roger that, thank you.
TLS is go for orbital access arm retract.
T-minus 7 minutes and counting. We've gotten a clearance to launch today. RTLS weather has is going to hold out for us for a 12:43 p.m. Eastern Time launch. Also, the weather at our Tau site is also clear for launch today. The orbiter's access arm is being retracted away from the vehicle at this time.
TV power is taken on.
Copy, NS2. OTC,
CL. Go ahead.
The fast heaters are still on.
Copy. CDR, OTC.
Roger. Fly step, feed line heaters coming off. OTC, CDR, that's complete.
Copy.
The gaseous oxygen vent hood is now being retracted away from the shuttle.
OTC PLT, the caution warning is clear, but no unexpected errors.
Copy, PLT. And with that, Columbia, OTC, I'd like to wish you all a very successful 2 weeks on orbit, and with that, close and lock your visors and initiate O2 flow.
Roger, thanks, Sandy, and initiating O2 flow.
TLS is go for ET, LH2, pressurization.
T-minus 20 seconds.
15.
T-minus 10, 9, 8. We have a go for engine start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Booster ignition and liftoff. Liftoff of Columbia on a multi-nation research flight.
Houston, Columbia, roll program.
Roger, roll, Columbia.
Houston now controlling. Columbia underway on its 17th trip to space. Columbia already traveling 250 miles an hour. Three engines on board Columbia now throttling back to two-thirds throttle to prepare the spacecraft to pass through the area of maximum air pressure and go supersonic.
Columbia, go with throttle up.
Roger, go throttle up.
Columbia's three engines now back at full throttle. Officer confirms a good separation of the solid rockets. Altitude now 172,000 feet. Columbia 33 miles east of the Kennedy Space Center. Now traveling 3,500 miles an hour.
Okay.
Well, I dropped Don Lincoln mid-deck through the camcorder, and you should have a still picture of us sitting on the flight deck right now.
That's affirmative. We got a real good picture, Bob.
Okay, well, here it comes. I'll narrate. This is just after main engine start, and the solids are going to light off here, and we're going uphill. We just completed the roll program there. tell you, it was a beautiful day for a launch. The main engine's lit on time, and Carl was a little worried from his previous flights, not worried, but he doesn't get excited until the solid's lit. And then when the solid's lit, we took off. It was great. I wish we could show you what you were seeing out the windows. Unfortunately, where the camera's placed, all we can get is the shaking inside. It, as you can see, vibrates pretty good on the solids, and we're being pushed back in our seats a fair amount, but nothing compared to the last 2 minutes of the flight when the main engines are really accelerating us out to our orbital velocity.
I tell you, Bob, from our perspective, this is great footage. We've just never seen anything quite like it.
Well, pay attention. We're coming up to SRB SEP pretty soon here. You can see the flash out the front windows. Jim and I have cue cards over the HUD to block the sunlight coming in so we can see all the displays, but you'll still see the flash from the SEP motors around the sides of them.
Then CLS is go for main engine start.
All vents open.
20 SRB ignition.
Lift off confirmed.
Houston, Columbia, roll program.
Roger, roll, Columbia.
Depot sees the roll.
Thank you. Guidance, your Delta State processor look good?
Looks good.
Thank you. Booster, how the three engines look?
Negative return. Columbia, Houston, negative return.
Booster flying?
Go fly.
Roger.
Three engines
negative
look
return.
Solid?
Three engines look real good flying.
Thank you. Prop, you go for the photo DTO?
Go.
I don't know how we doing it, Miko.
Nominal velocity flight. No under speed, no zone required. Go for the
Capcom.
ETSAP.
Okay, nominal.
Columbia Houston, nominal Miko, no ohms, one required. Go for the ET photo DTO.
Roger, go for the ET photo DTO, nominal Miko, plus X in work.
Hand over to Tedros.
Power system.
This is Jim trying to float for the first time in his life.
Go for it, man.
This feels really weird.
Get me to call the ground here.
Jim is floating.
Houston, Columbia, KU band antenna deployed. All nominal.
Oh, we got a CPL.
We do.
Okay. It smells like a lab.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what's the next step? Open hatch for CPL. Put the light on.
Rick, we're glad to see you folks come floating out of the tunnel. Now we're assured that this just isn't a mock-up somewhere on the ground.
Well, we had to look out the window and make sure that there was really a space lab out there.
Electrophoresis unit is used to separate proteins, and what we're doing today is we're trying to separate a mixture of proteins by applying an electric field against the current, a flow of a buffer solution with the sample stream of the protein. Okay, I'll just kind of go from top to bottom here.
Okay.
This is the Ramsey's facility here, and on the top is the power supply, followed by the control and display keyboard here, where we control all the pumps and, you know, input all the different things. This is the stowage, one of the stowage compartments. And here we have the different sample trays for the different experiments we're going to run. We have in here drawers that slide out. These are the sample bags here. This is the sample of the stuff that we're going to separate. We also have some more of these sample things in the crib, and after we're done collecting, we freeze the samples in the crib. Coming down, this is the main cell here. This is where the electrophoresis happens. And here's the cell buffer pump. It's a peristaltic pump with a bunch of different tubes, and just that's the medium that you separate stuff in. This is the sample compartment. The sample just slides right in here. Another peristaltic pump pumps the sample up through the chamber, where it then, you know, kind of separates like that. And this is the collection area. This is the collection tray. And the different, each 41, it collects every 41, all 41 samples, different ports. And this is just some of the plumbing of the equipment, you know, the different fluid loops, couple valves, things like that. That, in a nutshell, is the Ramsey's facility.
I'm standing here next to Bio-Rack. I think a Bio-Rack is sort of a mini space station because it's got, these are fruit flies, one of many experiments. There's some 200 containers with different science going on in most of them. It's got centrifuges for 1G controls. You can see those in the background. Got incubators that run at two different temperatures, and there's experiments from all over the world in Bio-Rack, so it's a lot of fun to work because there's a lot of different things. It's got its own cooler, And down below, it's got a glove box so that we can work with toxic things that we wouldn't otherwise be able to work with in space, because we can keep them contained inside the glove box. So here I'm putting some things in there. And here's a shot from right in front, just as I'm loading some things into the centrifuge. We stopped the centrifuge, put some containers in. That way we can do controls on board, do the exact same thing. They're in the exact same environment, except that some are being spun at 1G and some are being kept at 0G. And today, just for example, besides the fruit flies, I've irrigated some lentil seeds, which are going to be growing in space, and then we'll fix them later and sort of capture their development. Here I'm getting into stowage for a Nizimi, which lives right next to Biorack, and has a lot of similarity or a lot of relationship with Biorack. It's different in that it's got a variable speed centrifuge. Meanwhile, Chiaki is over on the at the workbench rack, working on some experiments that will go into FFEU. Here she's borrowing the Biorack glove box to inject some fluids from one syringe into another. She's going to use these to run in the FFEU electrophoresis unit, which we were able to rescue by sort of repeated IFMs earlier in the week. So we've been very happy to get to do some FFEU work because it's one of the facilities on board. And in fact, it was the last facility to repair. We've now had all the facilities working. In fact, we kind of added up over the course of the flight. We've been able to rescue significant parts of five of the 20 or so facilities on board with IFMs, between the newt, removing the newt, which was required to keep the fish package alive, and repairing the Eris Echo machine, which was required for both EDOMP and the Canadian spinal changes in microgravity, and then, of course, the FFEU that I already talked about, and the sort of lucky touch with the fingers to get the HRM data from the RRMD. Jackie's using a microscope here, just as you would on the ground, to look at the condition of the cells that are in these little cassettes. Here's a look at the Madaka, the fish that are in one of those little packages. Two males, two females. In the lower right corner, you might be able to pick out some eggs. It's a little bit hard to tell that.
Leroy.
Go ahead, George.
Yeah, the NASDA team traced back the last usage of that CCK mic, and it was during the newt injection, so it may have been left in the space lab.
With most of the eggs here.
Some of them have clearly defined tail buds, and I can see the tails and some of the gills starting to form with some of the eggs there. So they look, they all look pretty healthy here. I can see maybe one or two possibly eggs that aren't doing so well, but the other ones are all looking good.
Okay, Downs, that's very good news.
Now we got Trans 4 here under the camera.
Okay, so IFM W-48 for step 3, wait till the nozzle temps are greater than 200, and I'll check back when complete. We'll put it in work right away.
That's correct, Carl, and be advised you have 11 hours of bullage already accomplished in the dump.
Okay.
Don, just wanted to let you know that we've got loud down late now from the Ballarat glove box. Yeah, welcome inside.
who is back there busily working on experiments. The scientists back there have a real difficult timeline. Here's a reenactment. I just want to show you how Rick filled the syringe to overpressure the pump. We squeezed out a ball of water on the end of a straw, and that straw is not touching the syringe. The ball of water is just floating freely, and Rick is pulling back on the end of the syringe, sucking the water into it with no air. It really works slick.
And what I'd like to do this morning is give you a brief explanation about one of the major facilities we have here on IML-2. And this is the AAEU, which is short for Aquatic Animal Experiment Unit. And essentially, this is a aquarium in space. Divided up into two halves. Over here, we have the aquatic package. And on the other side, we have the fish package. And in the aquatic package, we have four water tanks. I'll pull one out here. And three of these tanks have red-bellied Japanese newts in them. And I'll hold this up so you can see it. We have one newt in two of the containers, and in one of the tanks we have two newts in there. And in all the tanks we have an egg chamber also with many different newt eggs in them, up to 70 or 80 eggs per water tank here. And what we're doing with this experiment is having the newts lay eggs in space, and we're interested in how these eggs develop, multiply and develop under zero gravity conditions. And we'll compare these eggs to those grown on the ground, ones that have developed under 1G conditions. So this is one of our red-bellied newts. One of them that I looked at just a few days ago, if you were watching, has laid 36 eggs already, so we know we have a number of great eggs for the scientists to look at. Besides the astronauts here, we have another tank with fish in it called Madaka. And these are small killfish. They're about the size of guppies. And we have four in there, two males and two females. And in this experiment, we're interested in the mating behavior of the guppies, of the Madaka fish here. And then on the fish package, we have goldfish. You might have seen some of the downlink from this, and I'll shine the light on there, and hopefully you can get a view of some of the fish swimming by. We have six different goldfish in here, and as you can see, they're looping around. They don't quite know which way is up, since we don't have a gravity vector here for them. And we've been watching and monitoring their swimming behavior for the last couple of days. We have a door up here that we open and close to give them the day-night cycles, just like they would have on the ground.
Okay, Don, we have some very good video of the goldfish now.
Okay, copy that. Let me know if you like the focus changed at all. I tried to get it in the center, right on their eyes.
Okay, PI says focus is very good.
Okay, copy. That's great. Okay, copy. Cooler transfer four containers, but to PTC-1, rack 1, Charlie.
That's a good copy. And these containers are 107, bone 3, from 108, bones 4.
Bayside, Huntsville 4, Leroy, we are getting downlink right now, and we're about to go LOS.
Huntsville Space Lab for Kimberly.
Go ahead, Leroy.
Kimberly, before I begin TEI, I'd like to reposition the slime mold here. If the PIs agree, I'm going to recenter the target.
That's affirmative, Leroy. The PI on the ground was just saying the same thing. We're going to have you do it after TEI, but you can go ahead.
Roger that. Jim and his tape change shots. I heard you kept him really busy this morning back there.
Go, Chiaki.
Yeah, Judy, thanks for waiting, and I'm ready to copy.
Huntsville Space Lab on Tempest. We want to do APO4, right? We're going to power cycle it.
That's affirmative. They were resetting some of their internal software, and they need you to do a restart.
Okay, it's coming right now.
Don sending a Panem message home before he goes to bed. Panem's really nice. It's nice to be able to communicate through the modem back and forth with folks back home and even you, Mario. And I left this in probably a little longer than I should. I just recording the MET and stuff here before I get started on the readings between the commanders and pilot seat on the flight deck. I just thought it was really neat to be able to work with equipment like this. You really adapt to microgravity very quickly, and it seems totally natural. Just using a piece of equipment, setting it off to the side, letting it float, and then writing something down or going off to something else. It just seems like you've been doing it all your life once you've been up here for a while. And my final scene for this morning, Chiaki was able to talk to the children at Tadabayashi School in her hometown via Sarex. Sarex has been a lot of fun. She wasn't talking directly via Sarex, but through a bridge in Hawaii. And she really enjoyed that. The children enjoyed it immensely. And it really has been nice to be able to talk to school children around the world. We've covered the southern U.S., Tokyo, and Germany now on this flight. And it always is an encouragement to them and to us to hear how excited they are about space exploration and answer their questions. I've been looking at a new lens, well, not a new lens, a different lens on the Hasselblad camera, same lens we always fly, but instead of the infinity stop set on the ground, we're focusing it in flight and looking at a different couple of different focusing screens to see how we might get more accurate pictures. We do an excellent job, as you know, documenting the changes in the Earth on our shuttle missions, and the Earth is constantly changing, and we want to ensure that we have the best pictures possible when we get home.
See it come out from underneath your wing. There's Orlando. Look at this. There it is. There it is. Beautiful. Very quiet here in Mission Control. All of Columbia's systems continuing to perform in excellent fashion. There are no issues at all in the room. Sonic booms announcing Columbia's arrival in the landing area. Landing gear is now down. Main gear touchdown. And nose gear touchdown. Columbia completing its 17th voyage in space, completing 236 orbits of the Earth, rolling out on runway 33 at the Kennedy Space Center, completing 6,143,000 miles.
Flight repositioning is completed and the probes are in transit.
Thank you.
On glide slope on center line.
Okay, on and on.
Columbia, Houston, on glide slope on centerline, surface winds 15084.
Roger. Maneuver complete. Houston, Columbia, wheel stop.
Roger, wheel stop. Welcome home, Columbia. Excellent, excellent job. Your record of 15 days on orbit for the shuttle has brought us closer to the next giant leap for humankind when we live permanently in space aboard the International Space Station.